Ladies and gentlemen, it is Wednesday, May 15, 2016. I'm Alex Jones coming to you here from the InfoWars News Center in Austin, Texas. David Knight is going to be co-hosting from the War Room as well today. And our intrepid reporters, Jakari Jackson and Michael Zimmerman, are going to be on the ground in California, where Trump is set to be speaking again tonight. Now, the pro-Democratic Party slash Clinton slash Bernie supporters running around with their red flags and F Trump t-shirts have, of course, made international news last night when they attacked reporters, police horses, random citizens' cars, and city property. And, of course, the reporters that were attacked were our reporters. Jakari Jackson was hit with a rock. He's been tear gassed before. Joe Biggs was hit with a rubber bullet in Ferguson, but that was a few years ago. This happened last night. And Jakari Jackson is coming up live with Michael Zimmerman. They've now gotten to California. Reportedly, they're getting off a plane as we speak, but as soon as they get in position, we'll be able to speak to them live. And David Knight is going to be interviewing them coming up. But Donald Trump has come out and said that these people should basically go home to their mommies, and that some of them are still wearing diapers, which I think is really an archetypal symbol of these people, a bunch of ignorant Arrested Development folks that want a bunch of freebies.
And the guys, oh, no, not another one. Where is he? How old is this kid? How old is this kid?
Get out of here.
Get out of here. Still wearing diapers. Look at this kid. Telling you, the kid looks like he's 10 years old. I've never seen him. It's unbelievable. That's the youngest protester I've ever seen. Actually, Ted Cruz had a very young one also. I've heard. I've never seen anybody like that. All right. And did you see? I said, get out of here. And he ran out. It was great. I wish everybody. Is it fun to be at a Trump rally? Well, I mean, is this the greatest? Yeah, all right. Get him out. Get him out. Come on. Go home to mommy.
Theme has emerged this morning when I was watching the videos, seven or eight of them, that Jakari and Zimmerman shot inside these melees in Albuquerque, New Mexico. These are people that are there trying to stop others from having free speech. They're there screaming and yelling hatefully. And most importantly, they're blaming Donald Trump for the corruption in America and for all of our problems. And as if he did all of this, not the Democratic and Republican parties that have been in power so long that are so scared of Donald Trump. So when we come back from break, we're going to play some of these clips today. But because of time constraints, obviously, there's hours of this. Go to InfoWars.com, and the videos are embedded in two different articles. The top story is anti-Trump mob attacks journalist horses during Albuquerque riot. Another night of mayhem caused by violent Bernie supporters. But then if you read mainstream news headlines, police in riot gear quell chaos outside New Mexico Trump rally. You have to read deeper into the articles to find out that these were anti-Trump, anti-free speech people, and mainly Bernie Sanders supporters. It's like when they caught the gay pastor in Austin false flagging Whole Foods because they had a surveillance camera that the cake didn't say fag on it when he left. None of them would say that he'd been caught lying, just that he dropped his lawsuit. You had to dig to find out that he'd set it all up. I mean, again, they cover up for their own people, even when they're attacking free speech and the press. We're going to go to break, come back, and break it all down on this very important Wednesday transmission, because a theme's emerging. Obama wants to censor. Hillary wants to censor. The communist Chinese are censoring. Europe's censoring. And now Facebook's coming in openly censoring. And the Federal Elections Commission says they want to censor drugs and the internet. They're coming not just for our guns, but for our children, our private property, our right to religion, our free speech across the board. And InfoWars is standing firmly against it.
you sent me with a freaking rock. What's your name, bro? You sent me with a rock. You. Yeah, you.
And that was Infowars.com reporter Jakari Jackson being hit with a rock last night in Albuquerque, New Mexico. Our reporters also witnessed other members of the press being attacked and just random people that were on the street in Albuquerque as a mob of, looks like close to 1,000 or more people showed up to try to frustrate free speech, try to stop Donald Trump from speaking. Now, I want to just point something out here. What Donald Trump is doing is genius. Some people say, hey, he's already won these states. They're not going to contest his nomination. They may still contest the nomination coming up in Cleveland in July. And so he shouldn't be traveling to California. I've seen this in the news. He shouldn't be going to Albuquerque because this just antagonizes people. See, his free speech is bad. And when they come and try to stop Donald Trump and his supporters are just people that want to go see what Donald Trump has to say. When they come and try to shut down their hard-won First Amendment, paid for in blood since 1776 and in countless wars that became the model of free speech worldwide, they're trying to pull down that precious thing and attack it. And the controlled corporate media, like MSNBC and others, going back to Chicago, you know, 6 months ago, have been trying to cover up that they are the ones that are violent, they are the ones that are hateful, they are the ones that are attacking innocent people, they are the ones using endless profanity, and even going after people that tell them, hey, I'm just in line to see Trump, I don't even agree with him. They've attacked their own fellow brethren, trying to get in to cause disruptions when the mob on the outside runs into their own infiltrators in the line. So, who are the bigger problems here? The dumb, mindless, conditioned, useful idiots that are programmed by mainstream media to really think Donald Trump's this fascist that hates them and wants to, you know, send Hispanics to Siberia? Or is it the corporate whore media that is sitting there preying on people? I want to play just an excerpt of this. The full video is up on Infowars.com from MSNBC and Chris Hayes. Headline, MSNBC panel calls out Trump for pushing the crazy vortex, close quote, of Alex Jones, Matt Drudge, conspiracy theories. And they go on to say, we talk about JFK. Trump talks about JFK assassination. You know, we talk about Vince Foster. We talk about the 90s. Well, of course it's fair game that people died mysteriously around the Clintons in the 90s. Of course it's fair game that they ran all sorts of scams and frauds and gave missile secrets to the communist Chinese. She wants to be president, co-president again. She says Bill Clinton will be co-president like an economic czar and run our economy. This guy that goes around swindling all these foundations, all these charities. I mean, enough is enough of the Bushes and the Clintons. Republicans and libertarians and conservatives rejected the Bushes and their attempt at another term, a fourth term, basically. Two of George W. Bush, one of George Herbert Walker Bush. This would have been a fourth term if Jeb got in. And we're simply saying we don't want more Clintons. And their response is to act like they control reality and go, it's crazy. He's going back in time. It's crazy. They're bringing up the JFK assassination as if they control reality, as if they're the real news and everything else isn't real. Because they have a bunch of people around a table laughing and giggling and ridiculing. That doesn't work anymore.
Yeah, we're going to play a clip from MSNBC in just a moment, what happened with that. But, you know, this is absolutely amazing what Alex was saying. The fact that we, and we've heard this before, we hear this every time there are these protesters, they say, well, you know, Trump shouldn't go to New Mexico and California. That's like saying this jogger who was raped in Central Park shouldn't go there because that area is owned by the rapists. Now these areas are owned by the racists who are telling us, no, you can't come here. You can't exercise free speech. Chicago, you know, that's Bill Ayer's university. We don't support free speech there. We don't tolerate dissent there. It's our view, or we're going to shut you down with violence. And that's what we're seeing here. You know, we've got an amazing program today. We've also got some amazing admissions from the Saudis. You know, we're starting to see this whole 9/11 thing unravel. The key to this was the 28 pages. And we couldn't get traction on that. Even when we had people who were sitting on the 9/11 commission, they couldn't get traction on this until we had Donald Trump enter this. And then it got traction. Now, first thing they did was National Review, of course, said that Donald Trump sounded like an Alex Jones caller. We've got another report today from the New York Times making fun of Trump because he gets his talking points, they say, from Alex Jones. Well, you know, the missing 28 pages of the 9/11 report is something that many have been talking about since this happened. Those who were part of the senior Senate Intelligence Committee, the chair of the Senate Intelligence Committee, they've been trying to get these pages declassified. We've just had the Senate come out and say they're going to allow victims' families to sue Saudi Arabia. So now the Saudis are saying, and listen to this, from Breitbart Israel, Saudi press says U.S. blew up the World Trade Center to create the war on terror. So we said this was going to unravel, and now we're starting to see the rats squealing on each other. Look, the Saudis have been intimately connected with the CIA for a very long time. And I think the CIA thought that they could throw the Saudis in on this thing and then cover it up with redaction, and it would all be fine. But now this whole thing is starting to unravel. Today, we're also going to have Dr. Francis Boyle on. He's going to be talking to us with an update about what's going on with the Zika virus. This is a man who is one of the world's foremost experts on bioterrorism. He wrote the bioterrorism treaties, and he's going to talk to us about the new GMO mosquitoes who are being used as a vector. Is this a test case? Is this something that was engineered for gain of function? Or is it just a false alarm? We're going to talk about all those possibilities. We're also going to have Joel Skousen, who's going to be joining us. He's going to talk about what's going on in Venezuela and other flashpoints throughout the world. And of course, this last weekend, we covered this last night on the Nightly News. This last weekend, Venezuela had a massive military exercise. 500,000 people in the military and the police were called out on a military exercise. Now, they said that they were aiming it at the U.S., that the USA is threatening to invade Venezuela. Nobody believes that. Not even the people in Venezuela believe that. They understand that with people starving and hunting dogs and cats on the streets of the major cities trying to find food, nobody can get food, they can't get medical care. They understand that they're right at the threshold of total revolution. There may be a military coup. They're trying to get a peaceful resolution of this with a recall election. But of course, they have to have 4 million signatures on this in a country that only has 30 million people. And as they got to 1.8 million, we had the dictator there, Maduro, say that if anybody who works for the government signs that petition for a recall election, they're going to lose their job. Well, in a socialist country like that, you probably don't have a job unless you work for the government. Do you want to lose your job as everybody is losing their food there? And this goes back 4 years to the banning of firearms, folks. We've covered this before at Infowars.com. The idea that 4 years ago they banned all firearms in Venezuela, and then they had victim disarmament zones, except they just call them disarmament centers, okay, where you turn in your weapons. And in this city, in this country where they cannot feed their people, they spent $47 million to set up these disarmament centers to collect people's guns. What happened next was they came after the police. They started hunting the police on the street to take their guns, hunting and killing them. We've reported about that at Infowars.com. So we're going to be talking to Joel Skousen about that and the breakdown of society in Venezuela and, of course, our politicians on the Democrat side. And this is what's so scary about this, folks. We see the same tactics happening in America, the same socialist policies that have destroyed Venezuela, they're promoting for America. We see Bernie Sanders, this charming old man to many, who is promoting the policies that are bringing this country into an Armageddon. And, of course, Hillary Clinton promoting gun confiscation. This is where the Democrats are leading us. This is what's so concerning about this, the fact that people look at these individuals and say, well, I don't like her, I don't like him, but I like this guy over here, never looking at their policies, never looking at what their policies have produced worldwide. It doesn't matter what area of the world it is. It doesn't matter the ethnicity of these people. It doesn't matter what their economy is based on. It's the philosophy, stupid. It's socialism. And socialism always leads to this. And so we're going to be talking about that with Joel Skousen. As we talked about these riots that are happening there, we've got a report that's up on the Drudge Report from Paul Joseph Watson. Did we go to war, Indiana residents ask? They had a massive military drill in Indiana. Why is it that it is paranoid when we say, why are you doing these massive drills? You know, Venezuela does one with 500,000 people in their military, and everyone's saying, look, they're doing it to intimidate their citizens. But of course, that's not why the U.S. government does these raids or does these drills. That had nothing to do with Jade Helm. They didn't put out Jade Helm to intimidate us. Oh, no. No, no, no. That wasn't about intimidation. And quite frankly, that was a little bit of what it was about. The key thing, I think, that Jade Helm was about was mastering the human domain. What does that mean? That means geospatial intelligence. And we're going to talk about how, as we have these drills, this military drill in Indiana, another SWAT team raid on jets, they said it was not a credible threat. And yeah, they come in with guns drawn, SWAT team on two different jets. People are tweeting out about this and saying, you know, I don't know what's going on. I hope I see you later. Scaring people to death, threatening people, even when they say it's not a credible threat. Well, you know what is a credible threat? What they are doing in terms of spying on us. We're going to talk about the reactions of Silicon Valley and the reactions of automotive companies because the cars are next. The FBI is coming to automotive executives and saying, you're going to cooperate with us. You're going to put back doors in the cars so we can spy on people like we do with their phones. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host, and we're going to be talking about a wide variety of issues today. It is absolutely amazing. You know, most days it's really like trying to drink out of a fire hose to see the news feed that's coming out. But today is especially heavy. We had our reporters who were in Albuquerque, New Mexico yesterday. Jakari Jackson got stoned. Yeah, they threw a rock at him, folks. Jakari doesn't get stoned that way. But very violent, and we've got a lot of clips that we're going to show that. Of course, we're going to talk to our reporters the bottom of the third hour. We're also going to have Dr. Francis Boyle, an expert on bioterrorism. He's going to be here with an update on the Zika virus and genetically modified mosquitoes as a disease vector. We're also going to be talking to Joel Skousen about Venezuela and other flashpoints. And as I just mentioned, you know, they've had gun control for 4 years in Venezuela. People are hunting now cats and dogs to eat in the streets after socialism has taken its full effect. They're also hunting down the cops to get their weapons because they've got gun control. And when they enacted gun control, one of the things that they did was to ban prepping. They called it hoarding. So you want to make sure, as we see ourselves being drugged down this path by the Democrat Party, the same path that Venezuela has been drugged down. Of course, Bernie Sanders praises Venezuela and Nicaragua. We got the clips from him 30 years ago. He comes back and he says, well, you know, I love the spirit of their revolution and everything. We saw where that happened in Nicaragua. Bernie Sanders won't admit to that. His followers don't care about socialism. They don't care about the ultimate effect of that. And of course, we got Hillary Clinton, who has economic advisors like Joe Stiglitz, who advocate the very policies that were implemented by Hugo Chavez and his successor, the bus driver, Maduro. They elevate this guy was a bus driver, okay? Kind of like, you know, making a president out of a community organizer. Maduro was a bus driver. Then he became a union leader. Then he got elevated to the highest levels, eventually became president in Venezuela. Ain't socialism great? You don't have to accomplish anything. They just put you, if they like you, they vote for you. You know, it's kind of like Bernie Sanders here. But when you think about this, when you think about the prepping and everything, understand now is the time to prepare before the shelves are empty, before the Democrats get in power, shut down our economy, take our guns, outlaw prepping, get your stuff, get your weapons to protect yourself from the mobs, from the Democrats. Right now, we've got a special on Survival Shield X2. 20% off. We've extended this sale. Of course, that's our nascent iodine. 99.99% pure iodine salt crystals that come from deep within the earth, lab tested for purity. Right now, you can get that for 20% off, just a limited time at InfoWarsLife.com. Also, we still have our InfoWars newsletter. Now, that's a free newsletter you can sign up for. You can find that at InfoWars.com/newsletter. If you sign up for that free newsletter, we'll send you a promo code, 50% off our two most popular t-shirts, a Hillary for Prison t-shirt and our Come and Take It t-shirt. And then with that free newsletter, you'll get a lot of unique content that'll be sent to you via email, as well as promo codes for many of the other products that we sell. So it's a way that you can connect with us, a way that we can thank you with specials that we offer from time to time. And again, that newsletter is free. And with that newsletter, you get 50% off if you sign up for it, 50% off of our two most popular t-shirts, Hillary for Prison and Come and Take It. Now, as I was pointing out in the last segment, we've got the New York Times coming out. And of course, we had the Wall Street Journal come after Donald Trump and call him an Alex Jones caller. That's the way they began their article when Donald Trump talked about the missing 28 pages in one of the Republican debates. Never mind the fact that we'd had Senator Bob Graham, Senator Bob Kerry, we'd had Reagan's Secretary of the Navy, Lehman. All of them had been on the 9/11 Commission. Graham and Kerry had been on the Senate Intelligence Committees. They were all decrying the fact that we had 28 pages that talked about Saudi involvement, they said, and they'd been liberally redacted. They said this needs to be declassified. And they've been talking about this ever since the report was finished. And they couldn't get any traction until Donald Trump talked about it. When Donald Trump talked about it, the mainstream media, which has remained silent on this issue, has never covered this issue. They have, whenever we covered it, and we've covered it constantly, they would say, you're a bunch of conspiracy theorists. And then when Donald Trump said something about it, they said, oh, he's a conspiracy theorist too. He listens to Alex Jones. That's why he's talking about this kind of stuff. Now it is starting to unravel. As I mentioned before, Breitbart News in Israel has a report here. The Saudi press says U.S. blew up World Trade Center to create a war on terror. And of course, we linked to this yesterday on Infowars.com. The Saudi press is still furious over the U.S. Senate's unanimous vote approving a bill that allows the families of 9/11 victims to sue Saudi Arabia. This time, the London-based Al Hayat Daily has claimed the U.S. planned the attacks on the World Trade Center in order to create a global war on terror. I'm going to break this down for you more when we come back. It is starting to unravel. The rats are starting to squeal on each other. We knew this would happen. That's why it's so important. Even if the 9/11 report is complete fiction, we need to get the rats squealing on each other. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host. As I pointed out earlier, we've been talking to Joel Skousen later in the show, as well as Dr. Francis Boyle. We've got our reporters who are in Anaheim now. There's going to be another Trump rally in Anaheim, and I guess a dreamer riot to go along with it. And we're going to talk to our reporters. We've got a massive amount of video that's on Infowars.com. It's linked by the Drudge Report. Here's the title of the article: Communist Anti-Trump Rioters Attack Police, Destroy Property in Albuquerque. Yeah, they smashed a glass door going into the convention center. They smashed police cars. Jakari was hit with a stone. Guy threw a stone at him. They were throwing all kinds of stuff at people in wheelchairs, okay? They should know better than to go there and to have a political rally that these people from Mexico don't like, because that's what they were doing. All of them waving, you know, they're burning American flags. They are carrying Mexican flags and yelling in Spanish as what the police called a gauntlet of hate. That was what the police called it, a gauntlet of hate for the people who are going to hear a political speech. You can't tolerate political speech. You shouldn't go somewhere like New Mexico because it's already been taken over by people who have no respect for our rule of law. And when I talk about our rule of law, I'm talking about our Constitution that says you have a right to free speech. They have absolutely no tolerance for other people's free speech. And, you know, we've talked, let me just say as an aside here, we've talked about George Clooney and his hatred for Donald Trump. Let's talk about what his wife did. His wife tried to prosecute a genocide denier from Turkey and put him in jail. Now, I believe there was an Armenian genocide. I think it's easy to establish that that fact of history. But Amal Clooney tried to get a guy from Turkey. Turkey wants to get into the European Union, so they want to say that Turkey never committed genocide against the Armenians. Of course, that's where the term came from. That was they coined the term genocide because of the way the Turks treated the Armenians. But Turkey wants to become part of the European community, so they've got to rehabilitate their image. So they've got a guy who is denying that the Armenian genocide ever happened. Fine. We can handle that. We've got such a thing as free speech. We can talk about history. We can show the facts. We can interview people. But their approach, the approach of the Cloonies, the approach of the Democrats, is to try to throw people in jail. And so Amal Clooney tried to prosecute this guy with the European Commission, tried to throw him in jail. That's the intolerance of the Democrats. That's what we're seeing in New Mexico, probably what we'll see in Anaheim, California as well. Coming after anybody that they don't agree with, trying to shut them up, trying to jail them. We see that from the people's eye. We need to jail climate deniers. We need to use the RICO statute against climate deniers. No, we're not going to have a scientific debate. No, we're just going to shut you in jail. That's the intolerance of the left. And that's why they're bringing these people in, these dreamers from Mexico who are doing this. Now, let's go back to what we were talking about before we went to break. The Saudis coming out and saying, hey, the U.S. blew up, the U.S. government blew up the World Trade Center so they could create a war on terror. They're upset about the fact that the Senate has unanimously approved a bill that would allow victims of 9/11 to sue the Saudis if they can prove in court that they had something to do with it. Now, that, of course, has been the government's narrative. They wanted to say the Saudis did this. They wanted to blame it on the Saudis, but then they didn't want the Saudis to be held responsible 15 years ago. So what they did was they redacted those 28 pages. This is what a Saudi legal expert wrote. This was published in London. He claims that the American threats to expose documents that prove Saudi involvement in the attacks are part of a longstanding U.S. policy that he calls victory by means of archives. And what he means by that, he says he claims the U.S. chooses to keep some cards close to its chest in order to use them at a later date. One example is to choose not to invade Iraq in the 1990s, to keep its leader, Saddam Hussein, alive, to use him as a bargaining chip against other Gulf states. Only once Shiism threatened to sweep the region did America act to get rid of Hussein, he says, since they no longer saw him as an ace up their sleeve. And he claims the 9/11 attacks were another such card, enabling the U.S. to blame whoever suited its needs at a particular time, first blaming al-Qaeda, then the Taliban, then Saddam Hussein's regime in Iraq, and now, he says, Saudi Arabia. He said September 11 is one of the winning cards in the American archives. He says experts who analyze the images in the video of 9/11 agree unanimously that what happened in the Twin Towers was purely an American action, planned and carried out within the U.S. Proof of this is a sequence of continuous explosions that dramatically ripped through both buildings. And I would add, because we've talked about this multiple times, the key is Building 7. Building 7, a steel skyscraper, collapses in its footprint, never hit by a plane, never hit by a plane. It had some minor fires going on. And we've talked to the firefighters who were there, said, yeah, they heard explosions going off, saw the building come down. Silverstein said, pull it. How did they do that? They would have to have demolition in place quite a while before that day. They didn't just throw the demolition in there. It takes a very long time to prepare that. That, in and of itself, shows the lie of 9/11. The key is Building 7. Alex is focused on this for a very long time. But he goes on to say, expert structural engineers demolished them with explosives while the planes crashed into them, only gave a green light for the detonation. They were not the reason for the collapse, but the U.S. still spreads the blame in all directions. Now, this guy who's writing this is a Saudi. Saudis are pushing back. He says the intention of the attacks, writes al-Shamari in his article, was to create an obscure enemy terrorism, which became what American presidents blamed for all their mistakes, that would provide justification for any dirty operation in any other countries, as well as the dirty operations that they do in America. The dragnet surveillance, the suspension of our civil liberties and constitution in the name of the war on terror. Because the war on drugs just wasn't doing it for them enough. They'd had that for 45 years. They needed something bigger, something broader. It says his article comes amid a torrent of vociferous articles in the Saudi press that range from accusing the U.S. of being schizophrenic and in cahoots with Iran. Isn't that interesting? Because, you know, Valerie Jarrett, essentially Obama's Henry Kissinger, is an Iranian. Yeah, did you know that? Did you know that her parents moved from Chicago to Iran? They were living there. She was born there. She grew up there. Iranian family values. There you go. Anyway, so now we're starting to see this happen. And of course, look, folks, if these buildings just collapsed like that, why haven't people, not just suing the Saudis, why aren't they suing the architects? All of the skyscrapers. And of course, we've pointed this out many times. No skyscrapers anywhere else in the world have ever collapsed from a fire. You can see skyscrapers that have burned for days in fires. And yes, they turn into kind of twisted metal, but none of them have even fallen over, or toppled over, let alone collapsed vertically down into their footprint like a controlled demolition. Why is it that when they had building codes after the Empire State Building was hit by a biplane earlier on, they had building codes saying, you know, these tall buildings could be hit by a plane. We need to design them so they can withstand being hit by a plane. Why hasn't anybody sued the architects of these buildings or the building inspectors in New York who allowed them to build a building that would fall down in its footprint when hit by a plane, or a building that would fall down in its footprint when not hit by a plane? Two planes, three buildings. Two planes, three buildings. Two planes, three buildings. Building 7 is the third building. So, and as we've had a guest, Tony Rook out of the UK doing documentary on this, he says, why is it that we haven't had changes in the way firefighters are instructed to fight these fires? We talked to him on the nightly news, interviewing a firefighter who resigned and said, look, if this is true, if steel skyscrapers can suddenly collapse in their own footprint without warning because of a fire, then we need to have a different approach to fighting fires in high-rise steel buildings. That hasn't changed either. So where are the lawsuits against the building inspectors, against the architects? Where are the changes in the procedures for the firemen? No, nothing changed except our Constitution. Nothing changed after 9/11 except our Constitution. Now, the New York Times comes out today, and here we are going down the same path again, because, you know, the Wall Street Journal said, look, Alex Jones is Donald Trump has turned into an Alex Jones caller because he's talking about the 28 pages. Now we see the New York Times coming out and saying, Donald Trump is pushing conspiracy theories. The right-wing media gets its wish. They come in here and say, ever since talk radio, cable news, and the internet emerged in the 1990s as a potent political force on the right, Republicans have used those media to attack their opponents through a now familiar two-step. Outlets like the Drudge Report and Fox News, along with radio hosts like Rush Limbaugh, they're personally broaching topics now, and they say Trump is personally broaching these topics, like Bill Clinton's marital indiscretions. Marital indiscretions. Say, that's the euphemism that the liberal press uses when they talk about rape being done by a Democrat. If a Democrat president rapes you, it's a marital indiscretion. That's the most amazing thing I've ever seen. How can these people put this stuff out with a straight face? The paper of record, really? The New York Times are supposed to respect these people, and the Washington Post after the hatchet jobs they're doing? I mean, come on. This is ridiculous, folks. They say, they have a quote from Rush Limbaugh. He says, Trump has gone to all of this Clinton conspiracy stuff, doing the job the American media and the Republican Party won't do. Well, you know, Sean Hannity had yesterday a brother of the Border Patrol agent that was killed in Fast and Furious. And I thought it was very interesting. He said that he had been contacted. He and his sister had been contacted by Donald Trump. Donald Trump showed up, met with him, didn't tell the media. And this was months ago. Didn't tell the media that he wanted to meet with him. He met with the brother and the sister of the Border Patrol agent who was killed. So we're going to get to the bottom of this. And he said last summer, Donald Trump did the same thing with his mother. He said it was nobody but Trump, his Secret Service protection, and he and his sister, and that Donald Trump had gone to his mother last summer. I think Donald Trump wants to get to the bottom of a lot of things that are bothering us. You know, we've got a lot of things that just don't add up. And we understand that the New York Times, the Washington Post, and the mainstream media have been lying to us. Bold-faced lies. We want some answers. And that's one of the good things about a Donald Trump presidency that'll come out of this. I think we're going to get some answers to some long-hanging things. I mean, look at what's happening already with 9/11, the missing 28 pages. And again, we said, if those missing 28 pages get released, it's going to cause things to start unraveling. Already, you're seeing this criminal alliance start to unravel. And people are starting to point fingers at each other because they're not going to take the rap for the other guy who set this whole thing up. So this is going to start unraveling. But let me read you the rest of this article, some excerpts from this article, the New York Times, talking about how Donald Trump is becoming a right-wing conspiracist, okay? They say his whole frame of reference is daytime Fox News and InfoWars, a website run by conservative commentator Alex Jones. And they, again, call us the lunatic fringe. They say they cite his willingness to appear on the radio show of Mr. Jones, who has claimed that Michelle Obama is a man. Okay, come on, folks. This is a parody. It's not serious. But, you know, if Michelle Obama were a man, if she were a tranny, wouldn't that be something the left would want to celebrate, not get angry about? I mean, wouldn't Obama be so happy about that? They could put tranny bathrooms all through the White House. You know, that would be something he would celebrate. And, you know, quite frankly, Obama, interestingly enough, is transitioning himself. You know, he transitioned from an Indonesian. You know, he had Indonesian values. He grew up in Indonesia. And this is not even in dispute, folks. This is not about the birth certificate. We know that Obama grew up in Indonesia. He got a Muslim education. He didn't grow up in America. He didn't grow up with American values. This is one of the reasons why we have things like natural-born citizen requirements in our Constitution. This is a guy who grew up in Indonesia. Then he transitioned into being an American. Now he's transitioning into being a globalist. Actually, what he's turning into, Obama is turning into an Asian. Yeah, he's trans-Asian, I think, because he's over in Vietnam, and he has now become a Vietnamese shoe salesman. Maybe that's going to be his next career, a Vietnamese shoe salesman. This is from McClatchy. Trade pitch turns Obama into a salesman for Vietnamese shoes. Okay, let's play a video of this. We've got Obama in Vietnam selling shoes.
I say this not to single out Vietnam. No nation is perfect. 2 centuries on, the United States is still striving to live up to our founding ideals. We still deal with our shortcomings. Too much money in politics and rising economic inequality. Racial bias in our criminal justice system. Women still not being paid.
He hates America,
doesn't he? As much as men doing the same job. We
you Vietnamese are so much better than us.
We're not immune from criticism. I promise you, I hear it every day.
Yeah, he hears it from himself.
But that's scrutiny.
Well, scrutiny.
That open debate, confronting our imperfections and allowing everybody to have their say, has helped us grow stronger and more prosperous and more just. So I've said this before, the United States does not seek to impose our form of government on Vietnam.
No, we don't seek to impose it on American.
I speak of, I believe, or not.
Okay, let's hold it right there. American let's make that clear. Obama doesn't seek to impose our form of government on the federal government. He routinely ignores the Constitution, bypasses it with executive orders, ignores the Fourth Amendment, ignores the Fifth Amendment, ignores the First and Second Amendment. There isn't any part of the American government that he wants to impose on America, okay? He wants a completely different system. He's made that abundantly clear. Let's talk about the trade issue here, because this is the key, I think, for Donald Trump. You know, when Roger Stone came here, I interviewed him once. And after the interview, I said to Roger Stone, I agree with Donald Trump on a lot of issues, but I said, I've got a lot of problems with him on some civil liberties issues, on eminent domain, other things. You know what Roger told me? He said, if we don't get Donald Trump in, we're not going to have a country. You know, this is an existential fight, folks, over the existence of America. And I came to realize that, you know, I want to see our Constitution restored. I want to see the Bill of Rights restored. They've been violated in every single aspect. But we're not going to have a Constitution or a Bill of Rights if we don't have a nation. This is a struggle of nationalism versus globalism. Senator Sessions has really led the way in this fight. He's made that clear. He's written op-eds himself. He's been educating Donald Trump since last August on the details of the Trans-Pacific Partnership that he was the only senator to take a look at, these transatlantic, trans-Pacific partnerships. He tried to educate the Senate. They didn't want to hear it. Donald Trump wanted to hear it. This has been something that he's been authentic on for decades. And this is a sovereignty issue, folks. We're going to have our economy managed abroad by people that aren't accountable to us in any way whatsoever. The same people who wrote this treaty are going to have their own rewrite of it. It's a living document, as Senator Sessions pointed out. They're going to be able to manage our economy. And, you know, we talk about the fact that, well, you know, Vietnam is making all these textiles and shoes and everything, things that used to be made in America, completely shut down. The textile industry in North Carolina, we're told that's a great deal. We need to have a service economy. It's so clean. No, you're going to be serfs in a servant economy. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back. I'm David Knight, and here's Alex Jones to respond to the New York Times hit piece. Alex?
Absolutely, David. Thank you for doing the show today. I've taped some special broadcast segments that will air later, early this morning, taking care of some really big news developments, very, very positive things right now. I don't just host the show and augment the nightly news. I also have to run the operations. I'm the CEO, the director, the chief cook, and bottle washer, and it's just powerful to be driving along in Austin, Texas, listening to David Knight on a local FM station. And then after I left that area, out of the listening area, I was able to just click over to the free iPhone app. It's just great to have this technology and to be able to listen to the great job you're doing, David. You know, the Saudis coming out and saying, hey, you know, yeah, okay, we're involved, so are you. Well, absolutely, it's these shadow criminal networks. But the reason I wanted to call in was that New York Times article that I had intended to cover today, obviously, because it came out yesterday. Look, I haven't wanted to brag on air. I haven't wanted to make a big deal out of this, quite frankly, because I don't want to give the enemy the intel. But they already have his phones tapped. They already know exactly what's going on with Trump. And years ago, people told me, hey, you know, Trump's really a patriot, knows about the New World Order behind the scenes, and is obsessed, you know, with something like the JFK assassination, obsessed with the Federal Reserve, and obsessed with globalism, and, you know, vaccines causing autism, because, you know, his youngest son, folks, that's kind of a big secret, but people should just look into that. That's why you don't see him out in public. So Trump, in the last decade's really woken up, and he's playing them. And they're scared. They're really concerned. Now, some of the elite think he might be playing the Patriots, is going to double cross, and just wants to take over himself. So either way, they hate his guts. But you wouldn't have a takeover artist like that who would actually be putting these issues out, because once you let the genie out of the bottle, it destroys the globalist. So the things he's saying against the New World Order, against globalism, about shadow government, the Clintons, and murder and rape is giant long coffin nails to them. But now that you have the New York Times saying, look, he gets his worldview from Alex Jones, from Infowars.com, and from Fox News. Well, Fox News is becoming us because we're the closest to reality. So what's happened is Drudge is probably the biggest media outlet in the world for aggregating information. We're large as well, but, you know, probably a third that size. But our information analysis is so hardcore, it's amplified by Drudge, it's amplified by Patriots, it's amplified by military people, it's amplified by folks that are informed. People know that our guest, our research, our analysis is extremely powerful. And folks are waking up that we've really been taken over by a foreign world government, because the globalists are out in the open admitting we've got a world government that's corporate. So they want to have their cake and eat it too and say there is no corporate world government, but at the same time there is. Or the vaccines are safe, but we just recall the polio vaccines. It's got live cancer virus in it. That was 3 weeks ago. Something I've said 10,000 times in 20 years. I probably say it every day. Don't take the polio vaccine. I mean, you know. So people know. Harvard comes out and says, yeah, fluoride brain damages you, gives you bone cancer, reduces fertility. Well, they knew that in the 20s. We're being validated in spades, in triplicate. We're also going out and showing the violent anti-free speech people. Just InfoWars doing that is blowing their operations. And Drudge linking to us. So it's showing what a paper tiger these people are. And it's such an epic time to be alive, because the talking points we've put out that are dead on about what's going on have now spread to Limbaugh, Hannity, everybody else. Michael Savage was pretty much always there to a certain extent. He certainly always knew. He's hardcore, getting more hardcore. And so they can't shut us all up. So they sit there saying, we're the legitimate media. We're God. We tell you what to believe, when they have a 6% trust rate. So David, it's an epic time, and to have the New York Times saying, look, he gets his info from Alex Jones, it's worse than that. He's going around behind the scenes, folks. I already knew this. Talking to everybody. Trump thinks he's going to save America. He's for real. He's a patriot. We basically are about to have an Alex Jones billionaire as the president, okay? Yes, tell your children. Not to hear a word about what we're about to say. No, the truth is they've tried to suppress us. InfoWars is only one focal point of people waking up to the true corporate global governance we're under. That corporate governance worldwide, where it's in control of about 80% of the planet, is setting up the universities to teach total totalitarianism and to arrest and shut down anyone that disagrees with the whole corporate Borg takeover. And humanity is, again, just explosively waking up right now to what's happening. And we have a fighting chance. So we have CNN, MSNBC, and the New York Times all on the same day saying it's horrible. He's talking about JFK. He's talking about New World Order. He's talking about vaccines. He's talking about rape and murder. All of it's real. All of it's true. So they have to act like what we're doing is discrediting, not because they think it's discrediting, but some weaker-minded people that still haven't woken up hear it and go, oh, my gosh, Trump's crazy. Yeah, he's crazy like a fox. He's winning. He's surging. The more hardcore he gets, the more support he gets. And so that's why this is so special and so amazing. And then I personally already knew. Of course, we had Ryan Terry's brother on last week and others. And had him on months ago, had him on years ago. I knew behind the scenes that Donald Trump was going around investigating Fast and Furious and the Clintons. I knew that he was investigating the birth certificate and Obama's providence 8 years ago before anybody else was. And the truth is, Donald Trump is what you call a free thinker, what the mainstream media calls a heretic, or in modern parlance, a conspiracy theorist. He believes they ordered a stand down at Benghazi. They did. He believes they rigged the stock market. They now admit they did. He knows they're rigging the currency rates. They now admit they do. He's a realist. He's not a chump. He's a self-made guy that's made $40 billion and himself made $8 billion. I'm not saying he's perfect, but I'm telling you this. The guy is taking on the globalist. The guy basically sees it as a do-or-die suicide mission. And I don't just know this from Stone or other people. I know it from a bunch of folks. I'm just going to stop right there, okay? Trump, behind the scenes, knows more than I do. And Jerome Corsi, he's known him 40 years and worked with him. Of course, he's big in banking, big in finance, big in construction. He's told you on air. I asked him to say what he told me privately on air. He did it. He said, look, don't worry, Alex. Donald Trump knows everything. And I said, what do you mean? He goes, he knows more than you or I do. So the truth is, Trump knows it all. He understands the whole program. And he went to Scotland for a month a few years ago and almost didn't do it. And just said, look, I can't let them destroy the country. I got to take these people on. They want to make everybody poor. They're scum. I'm going to take them on. And, you know, when you get a kid takes the vaccines, you believe in the system, and then your kid gets autism, and you're hearing it here, folks. They keep it private. They don't want it out. But, you know, his son got damaged by vaccines. You understand, even at that level, nobody's insulated from this new world order. And, I mean, Robert De Niro got intimidated, but he came back. He's coming out with a new vaccine film himself. So the truth is, when the men get off the bench, tyrants fall. And tyrants know they're in a battle now. So listeners know this. We're about to get a lot more reinforcements. And we don't hang our hat on Donald Trump. He's only one manifestation of that. Okay, just like Ron Paul was a manifestation and got the word out. You are the Paul Revere's. Epic history's happening. And thanks to Matt Drudge, WorldNet Daily, and a few other groups that have been around as long as I've been or even longer. And look, WorldNet Daily's not been perfect at some levels, but they're good folks overall. Because of those folks, we have a real shot. Because of you, because of Ron Paul, because of Barry Goldwater, because of countless other people like Red Beckman and just too many to list, and Jack McLam. Because of all those patriots fighting the last 50, 60 years, American culture now is this. We actually are the culture. We actually have been dug in, getting ready, trying to stop the takeover, but now it's here. Okay, the enemy just took over an awake population of probably 40% that know how to cow the cabbage. This is epic. This is history. This is 1776, part two. You are the resistance. David Knight's taking over.
Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and in this segment, we're going to be talking to Joel Skousen, no stranger to those of you who listen to the Alex Jones Show. Of course, his website is worldaffairsbrief.com, or you can find him at joelskousen.com. One of the things that Joel Skousen talks about, of course, we sell it here at the InfoWars store, are books about how to create a secure home. He has a book, The Secure Home, Architectural Design, Construction, Remodeling of Self-Sufficient Residences and Retreats, and also strategic location, where to build in order to be safe in North America. Now, perhaps one of the people who's read his book, I don't know, would be Zuckerberg, because we got this post from the New York, is Zuckerberg building a secure bunker next to his home? I believe it's up on the Drudge Report as well. And what they say is Mark Zuckerberg, we mentioned before in the news, other people covered it earlier in the week, that he was tearing down four homes that surround his $7 million mansion in Silicon Valley. But now the New York Post says what he's building appears to be a high-security stealth compound. Indeed, one of the homes looks like a possible security bunker with white brick walls, dark steel doors and windows, dark gray siding and louvers where they occur above the roof line, and dark gray standing seam metal roof, according to the plan. So it's interesting. You know, we see these billionaires, the elites, relocating to different areas of the world. Also, we've talked about in the past, George Clooney built last year or 2 years ago He built a panic room in his UK castle. So they're taking care of themselves, and we need to understand what's going on. One of the things I wanted to talk to Joel Skousen about was what's happening in Venezuela. We see our presidential candidates on the left. We see Hillary Clinton using Joe Stiglitz as her economics advisor. We see Bernie Sanders praising 30 years ago the Nicaraguan Sandinistas and Daniel Ortega and all those people. And now he comes back and says, well, I was praising the spirit of it. And of course, Hillary Clinton took him to task for praising the spirit of oppression. Nevertheless, she wants the same kind of economic policies that have led to the ruin of Venezuela. And Hillary Clinton wants to confiscate guns. And now we've got a situation, as I pointed out earlier in the show, we reported back in December that the police in Venezuela were being hunted down on the streets for their weapons. That's what's going to happen in America. That's why a lot of law enforcement doesn't support gun confiscation, because they know they're going to be the point of the spear. They're going to be the targets of criminals who are going to come after them for their guns. That's just one of the bad results of gun confiscation. So joining us now is Joel Skousen. Welcome, Mr. Skousen. I don't have his audio. Do we not have his audio there?
I can hear you, David.
Okay,
can you
good.
Hear
me now? We got your audio. Good, good. Welcome, Joel.
Thank you very much, David. Good to be with you.
What do you make of Venezuela? Because we had this last weekend, a massive military drill of 500,000 soldiers. And, of course, Maduro is saying, oh, this is targeted. This is a warning to Americans not to get involved. But nobody is believing that. They all believe that this is a warning to the citizens who are starving in the streets not to create an insurrection and also to shut down efforts to have a recall election.
Well, this is an interesting situation, David, because Maduro's popularity has dropped to 22%. He enjoyed no less than 3 or 4 years ago almost 80% popularity, at least among the indigent people of which socialism and his form of communism appeals to.
I can't believe it's 22%. I mean, people are hunting cats and dogs in the streets, and he's got a 22% positive rating?
Yeah. That's incredible. You've got to remember, there's that many hardcore leftists and communists in Latin America in any one of these countries, and so that's very, very believable. But it's remember that in December of 2015, the opposition parties, the Unity Democratic Parties, won it's over a two-thirds majority in parliament, so they now have the power to remove Maduro from power. And they were planning on doing that. They've been gaining petitions for a plebiscite on that issue. And then Maduro calls for a state of emergency on May 16th, just last week. And that state of emergency has effectively stopped the government from removing him from office. We have to remember, too, that Maduro has replaced all the military officers with cronies. So there is no possibility of a coup. Actually, Chavez did that a long time ago. That's the traditional way in which a very unpopular president would be removed from office in Latin America. And he's also stacked the Supreme Court. And this and the opposition parties were in the process of removing these corrupt Supreme Court members and replacing them with more moderates. And that state of emergency has stopped that as well.
You know, of course, he has an incredibly high standard there in Venezuela to have a recall election. They have to have 4 million signatures. This is a country with a population of only 30 million. So that's, about 13-14% of the population has to sign a petition. And as they started getting there, they got about halfway there, 1.8 million signatures. That's when he enacted a state of emergency, as you pointed out, for 60 days and threatened anybody who has a job with the government, which is probably anybody who has a job at this point, threatened to take their job if they signed that petition. And I guess those are the 22% of the people who are supporting him in the opinion polls.
Well, worse yet, crime is the worst, second worst in the world. Honduras has the highest per capita crime. Guatemala is up in there, and El Salvador is really bad too. But over 90% of crimes in Venezuela go unsolved and unprosecuted. And as you say, you know, they are taking down policemen to get their weapons. It's getting to be a literal free-for-all in terms of, people fighting it out for food. The black market is running rampant. Nobody uses the currency except for napkins and toilet paper in Venezuela.
The currency itself has become a kind of form of toilet paper. They can't even afford to print new fiat paper money. You're talking about the crime situation there. And last night we talked about this a little bit. We had a video that was a lady from Venezuela. She talked about how bad crime was there. And, of course, the NRA put that out. And that's one aspect that we're going to see when we have gun confiscation. But then the other aspect, as you alluded to just there, was the fact that officers are being hunted for their guns. Here's some of the statistics back in this article we had in November. 24,000 murders recorded in 2013. 252 police officers hunted and killed in the country from January to October of last year. So that was just before this article was written, because they wanted their guns. That's what's going to happen with gun control. And Joel, I see the same things being put in place by the Democrats. Of course, Hillary is full on for gun control. And we see coming up in California a race between the president of the Senate and the lieutenant governor, both of whom want to run for governor and become governor in that heavily Democrat state, both racing to see how many gun control measures they can enact and, you know, to make themselves more popular. There's 11 different sweeping gun control measures, three of them about registering ammunition purchases, also having background checks for ammunition. I mean, this is really getting serious in California. Venezuela has become a template for what the Democrats want to do in this country, and California is becoming the next step in that enactment.
Well, that's right. You know, as the author of Strategic Relocation, I get an awful lot of calls and emails from people from California saying, all right, I'm ready to leave. This is the last straw.
Yeah.
You know, the confiscation is very real, looming. But, you know, that which is really driving people out of even the public school system, of course, is the enforcement of transgender bathrooms and other sex education upon people. But absolutely. Before we leave Venezuela, let me just say, David, that one of the reasons the problem is so chronic in Venezuela is that they took a $50 billion loan from China in 2005, and they sell over 600,000 or 600 million barrels of oil to China, and they have to give 50% of that towards debt payment. So even at low oil prices, they've cut their income in half by indebtedness to China.
Wow, that's amazing. But and a lot of people will say, well, what's happening in Venezuela is simply because of oil. But we've seen this happen throughout Central America. We've seen it happening in Bolivia. We see it happening in Brazil. We see it happening regardless of what the economy is based on. And of course, when we look at socialism, that creates an economy that is based around, doesn't have a diversified economy because people don't have the freedom and the flexibility to create new products, new markets. So it's just going to be the industries that are owned and mismanaged by the central government, the central planning. It's not really foreign intervention that they want to blame it on. They should be blamed on the intervention of their central government. And that's the key. When we look at what Bernie Sanders was saying 30 years ago about Nicaragua, he was praising the fact that they had won this in spite of American intervention. And yes, we know the CIA has created its own share of coups, but it's not American intervention that is bringing down Venezuela. It's their own intervention in their own economy, isn't it?
It is. And I want to reinforce what you're saying about the inherent allure that has always been in Latin America. You've got a high proportion of very poor indigent people in Latin America. And so socialism's always had a big draw. But well over 50% of all the countries in Latin America are in the hands of actual communists. A lot of people don't realize because the media never publicizes. They call leftist progressives, you know, they don't, and they call, even full communists just, on the far left. They just don't want to use the C word. But Dilma Rousseff of Brazil, who's just been temporarily suspended in an impeachment proceeding, is a full communist, revolutionary. Her predecessor, Dilma Rousseff, and then Lula da Silva of Brazil was a full communist. They still hold to this day an annual conference in Rio de Janeiro called the Foro, meaning Forum of Rio de Janeiro, which is an annual meeting of communist revolutionaries and how to continue the struggle.
And I would like to talk to you when we come back from the break. I want to go a little bit more into Brazil if you want to talk about that, because I think it's very important. You know, there's a common thread besides the socialism between Venezuela and Brazil, and that, of course, are voting machines. Most people don't realize that the largest electronic voting machine company in the world comes out of Venezuela. It's called Smartmatic. It was created by friends of Hugo Chavez as a tool of political control in Venezuela, and it has been accused of rigging elections throughout Central and South America, places like the Philippines as well. And, of course, we had the GOP bring it in for the Utah primary. They paid $80,000 for Smartmatic voting machines in our own country, the GOP. Stay with us. We'll be right back with Joel Skousen. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and we're talking to Joel Skousen, an expert in preparedness, securing your home, finding a secure location. We sell his books at InfoWars.com, of course. One of the articles I came across, and we were talking about what's happening in Venezuela and everything that brought this up, was this massive military exercise they did over the weekend. 500,000 soldiers in Venezuela. And they said, well, this is to show of force for the United States. Nobody believes that anywhere. This is a show of force for their citizens. But they've been showing force to their citizens for quite some time. Look at this article from DC Clothesline. Did you know Venezuela banned guns for private citizens only 4 years ago? Yes, I did. But here's one interesting thing from that article. Here's a quote about what they did for people who were prepping. They say this was about the same time when they outlawed the guns, spent $47 million in this bankrupt kleptocracy to create disarmament centers. You know, we talk about the gun-free zones being victim disarmament centers. No, these are literal disarmament centers that they set up, spent $47 million to confiscate people's weapons. It was about the same time the government declared prepping illegal, said those who were quote-unquote hoarding could be detained on criminal charges, and when the company country instituted a fingerprint registry for purchasing groceries. There you go. And if you bought more than you were allotted, then they would come after you. This is why you need to prepare now for your family. Now, of course, we sell InfoWars select storable food. We also have a sale right now on Nascent Iodine, 20% off Survival Shield X2, Nascent Iodine. Prepare for yourself now. Prepare for your family now. Because all the stuff that we're seeing has happened in Venezuela are things that Bernie Sanders and Hillary Clinton want to have happen in this country. From their economic policies to their gun confiscation, you name it, it's on the way. This is endemic to socialism. So joining us again is Joel Skousen. We were just talking, Joel, about what's going on in Brazil, and I pointed out that one of the big exports from Venezuela has been their voting machines. Of course, there was a cry about voter fraud when the president of Brazil, who has just been impeached, when she was elected. She was way behind in the polls, 10% behind the polls. She was being booed in soccer stadiums with 60,000 people there. But all of a sudden, she wins the election with these electronic voting machines, and then they shut down exit polls, which they normally would take exit polls. Your comments?
Well, exit polls have always been the primary restriction on voter fraud, even electronically. They just don't dare change the ultimate result more than 10% of exit polls. And so when you're going to do that, you have to shut down exit polling. And that's what happened in last year's election, even in the United States. You didn't find any exit polls. Mm-hmm. When they defeated Romney, I have estimated that they actually eliminated over 8 million votes to defeat Romney versus Obama. But they're obviously doing that in Venezuela and Brazil.
And, of course, the interesting thing, Joel, is that when they do the exit polls, and they do the exit polls, they just don't report them in most cases. What they'll do is they'll tell us, well, if this demographic went for this particular, you know, men went for this candidate, women went for that one, or they'll slice it in different ways. But they won't say in their exit polls how many people voted for candidate A, how many voted for candidate B, so you can compare it to the actual results that they're going with.
And that's why it was important that in 2012, when Romney was defeated, it was the first time in the United States that the state results were tallied at the federal level. In other words, there was no way for an individual state to see if their tally had been part of the 8 million votes that disappeared, unless all the states at one time requested an audit simultaneously.
Wow. And when we're looking at this voter fraud, I did a report on this after the Utah primary, because I saw Smartmatic had been brought in by the GOP there. They spent $80,000 to bring in this Venezuelan electronic voting machine company to tally their GOP primary. In some of the countries where Smartmatic had operated, they had shut down mysteriously and lost millions of votes, tens of millions. In one country, it was 24 million votes just disappeared. And that's the amazing thing. There is no audit trail. And with these electronic voting machines, they're taking something which ought to be very, very simple math. We need to have the ability to look at who the voters are, as well as the way this is tallied and transmitted, have a paper record. But with electronic voting, they take all of that away, don't they, Joel?
That's right. And making votes disappear, you know, they traditionally, it's very easy to write a program that erases itself after it's implemented, that flips votes. And we saw that in the Texas primary with electronic voting, where, you know, they took votes from Donald Trump to beef up for Ted Cruz and others. But making votes disappear is an even tougher thing if you don't have a paper audit of totals. And that's, I think, the massive fraud that went on at the federal level to defeat Romney.
Absolutely. We see it over and over again. And of course, we've seen news reports where people brought in some college hackers to put a little program into the voting machine to switch all the votes and then erase itself after the fact. That's exactly what can be done. Stay with us. We're going to be right back with Joel Skouser. We're going to talk about what's going on in Japan with the outrage over an American Marine arrested in connection with the death of a woman on Okinawa. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and we're talking to Joel Skouser of... let's see, I've got your, what's your website, Joel?
WorldAffairsBrief.com.
Yes, yes, WorldAffairsBrief.com. Thank you. It just slipped my mind there for a moment. We've been talking about what's going on in Venezuela and South America. We're going to move it to the Pacific now in just a moment. But before we leave the elections, I saw this interesting story on WND. And I wanted to mention this, Joel, because I have personal experience from friends in North Carolina where something like this similarly happened. They're saying, hundreds of dead voters are casting ballots decades after dying in L.A. People voting from the grave in L.A. County. Hundreds of so-called dead voters in Los Angeles County alone. They said there were 215 votes from the grave. They say this one individual, John Sinker, passed away in 2003, yet records show he was able to vote in 2004, 2005, 2006, 2008, and 2010. And I had the same thing happen, Joel, in North Carolina. My brother-in-law, who still lives there, had a friend who went to vote. And in North Carolina, you do not have to show a photo ID. And, of course, efforts to say that we want to have some kind of a photo ID, like driver's license, have been attacked by the Democrats as being racist, as intimidating people. I don't know why they're not intimidated when they have to show ID for the millions of other things that they do in their everyday life. But when you go to vote in North Carolina, you just walk up and you give them a name and an address and they look it up and they say, okay, here you are. And they don't verify who you are with a photo ID. Now, what happened with my brother-in-law's friend, he said, I went to vote. I gave him my name and they said, you've already voted. And he said, they looked at it and his mother was on the voting roll who had already died. And they said, she's already voted as well. So all they have to do is go through the phone book and they can go in and rig these votes. And of course, they've extended the voting periods on this. I mean, it is incredible the amount of fraud and the different places in which that fraud can be injected into our process, isn't it?
Well, actually, David, it's you can't really do this by going through the phone book. This has to be done with access to archives and records. And thus you have to have collusion with the local state administration. In L.A., for example, it's controlled by the Democrats, and that's where you're getting this systematic voter fraud. I mean, this is not done easily, and when it's done on the scale that it's been done in L.A., you know it's official or unofficially official.
And, of course, we're seeing them saying, we don't even want to have people require that people have citizenship in order to vote. We've seen many jurisdictions where the Democrats have done that. I mean, it is so over the top, the fraud that we're seeing here. And when the Bernie Sanders people, the one thing I'll agree with them on in terms of this election is what's happening with the superdelegates. She started out, Hillary Clinton started out with 15% of the votes that she, the delegates that she needed to win the nomination. And every time we look at these areas where Bernie Sanders beats her by 10 to 15%, she winds up getting the same number of delegates because they have 10 to 15% of the delegates are superdelegates. So he can still beat her in all these elections that are proportional on the Democrat side. He can beat her by 10 or 15%, and yet she still gets the same number of delegates because that they've reserved that number as superdelegates.
And it's hurting her in the polls now. Yeah. I mean, for the first time, we're seeing Trump starting to approach getting even in the polls with Hillary Clinton, and that was unthinkable 3 months ago in terms of polling. But she is so unpopular with the Democrats, I don't think she's going to get the percentage of Bernie Sanders voters that they think they are.
Yeah, it is interesting to see this war erupting. Everybody was thinking that she was going to have this thing sewn up, that the Republicans are going to be fighting amongst themselves at this point, and yet the whole narrative is flipped. Now we've got the Democrats in a death struggle for the nomination, a lot of bitterness rising, and there's a good reason for that bitterness to rise because of the rigging of the system through the superdelegates. But I think it's very interesting to see what's happening with this. It's really going to damage her, I think, for the general election, don't you?
No, I do think so. And that's why they're trying so hard to control and co-opt Donald Trump, because there's a very real possibility. I mean, the polls are generally fudged anyway. We saw that in all the phony surges they ran in polling to try to defeat Romney for the nomination in 2012. So we really can't trust polling. But nevertheless, so I think, you know, this is a very real possibility. They may be dealing with Donald Trump, and so they've got to co-opt him. That's why the meeting with Henry Kissinger and the multiple conversations. Paul Ryan is saying that he's about to resolve the conflict between he and Trump. His staff is denying that he's going to endorse him, but I think it's going to come pretty close to an endorsement.
How do you feel about that meeting between Kissinger? Because the one thing I heard Donald Trump say after that was he kind of joked. He goes, yeah, he meets with me and tells me how angry China is that we're not doing this. I mean, he almost kind of like almost like a backhanded comment towards Kissinger, you know, like, yeah, I met with him, but you know, he's putting pressure on me from the Chinese. He's acting like an ambassador from the Chinese is the way I read that comment.
Well, he always has been a representative of the Chinese. I mean, Kissinger has been accused because of his time in East Germany as a double agent, as being a communist. And he may have let the communists think that he was, but Kissinger is clearly a globalist.
Oh, yeah.
And so he's probably playing both sides. He clearly, you know, is almost solely responsible for bringing China into the First Nation status that it is, mm-hmm. both in terms of a member, not only of the UN replacing Taiwan, but a member of the Security Council with veto power. And of course, the globalists want that for conflict creation. So he did represent China's view to Trump. He talked about how Trump is fearful, or China is fearful of a Trump victory. He did that kind of to play up to Trump. Trump is sadly very susceptible to flattery. And, you know, Kissinger knows how to pour it on. I think Trump has some idea a little bit about what, you know, Kissinger is about. But I'm not as convinced as Roger Stone is, for example, that Trump really understands the 9/11 conspiracy or the globalist conspiracy like he says he does.
Well, time will tell, won't it? I think his comments, the way I read his comments, I thought it was a pretty offhanded comment to Henry Kissinger. Certainly he's going to need to meet with these individuals as they come to him. I mean, it's kind of like Don Corleone saying, I want to talk to you, you know, but when he comes out, he goes, yeah, this guy's nothing but an agent of the Chinese. And I think we all understand that. We've seen that it was Kissinger who opened up had the great opening to China. But of course, they have pushed China to take over our industry and our manufacturing. As people look at this, Joel, I mean, we see all these articles that are up on the Drudge Report today about all the different robot positions taking over jobs, taking over hamburger flipping, but also taking over farming, taking over white collar jobs. But we understand that we have already eviscerated our economy by getting rid of our manufacturing. They kept telling us, hey, it's going to be great because we're going to have a service economy. And yet, as Gerald Celente has said, you know, when you got a service economy, you're nothing but a servant. You know, you are a butler or whatever. You're not going to get wealthy. You can't keep yourself free. You've lost the engine of wealth creation if you lose your manufacturing base. It isn't simply an idea that we're going to be able to buy our shoes and clothes at a cheaper price because we've got slave labor making it for us in China or in Vietnam. We're going to become dependent and passive. And to me, I look at these things that are coming down the pike with automobiles, and now they're selling us, after they've sold us a service economy, they're selling us a renter economy, where we don't own anything. They already talk about themselves being the stakeholders, us not owning anything. Now I think they're moving us to the point where not only are we servants in a service economy, but now we're going to be renters who don't own anything, including even our own cars.
And we mustn't forget the ultimate threat to internet or to national sovereignty in a war situation when you don't have steel manufacturing capability.
Yes.
When your chips for military equipment are manufactured overseas, how do you get it to your supply chain in a wartime economy? This is the real vulnerability which we're facing, because certainly Russia and China are building towards a war economy and building massive weapons of mass destruction as we disarm.
Let's talk about what's going on in Japan. This article from the Washington Post, outrage in Japan as U.S. Marine veteran is arrested in connection with the death of a woman on Okinawa. Your comments.
Well, this is a hot topic. As a former Marine pilot, I can tell you that Okinawa has been a hot topic ever since I was a pilot. Kadena Air Force Base, or not Air Force Base, but Marine Base there is a major operational base. We have nuclear, we used to have nuclear weapons in Japan. Those were taken out. There's a very strong leftist component to Japanese politics that have lobbied for a nuclear-free Japan. Japan is reversing that under Prime Minister Abe, trying to convince his country to bring on, they're getting, you know, Aegis-class destroyers and other things. And they're even, most importantly, starting to move into the disputed islands to combat Japan. Now, there's a grudge match brewing in World War III against China and Japan. And so Japan really has to get on board with defending itself. Right now, the U.S. is a major component of that in Okinawa, the major series of bases in Japan. But, you know, about several years ago, there was a gang of three U.S. servicemen that abducted a 12-year-old girl in Okinawa and gang raped her. And now this rape, or this, and probably a rape and murder that occurred with a Marine civilian. Actually, he retired, came back. He had married a Japanese wife, brought the wife back as a civilian contractor. And what's most irritating to the Japanese, David, is that the U.S. has this agreement that all military personnel are exempt from Japanese law. They have immunity while they're there, and they extended that agreement to civilian contractors.
Wow.
And so
he's
not being allowed to be prosecuted locally. And this is what is enraging the people. The U.S. just doesn't need this if they're going to extend power towards the China threat.
I don't fault the Japanese at all for being outraged by that. I would be outraged by that as well if I were them. That's absolutely incredible that they would do that, that they would exempt them from prosecution for crimes like this, even people who are retired and are private contractors. I mean, that's just incredible.
Well, this is a problem person, especially vis-a-vis Japanese woman. You know, when he marries a Japanese woman and then goes attacks and has an affair with another Japanese woman, and this is a predator that, you know, the military has a very bad reputation. We had it in Vietnam about sexual predators and creating a whoring economy. And this is what's happened in large parts of Okinawa with brothels due to the U.S. Marine Corps presence there. And I think the U.S., just as in my day, they had to get a handle on all of this whoring around in the Tailhook Convention and had to, you know, they supposedly cut it out, but they really put it underground. And it's still there in the Marine Corps. There is a tacit admission that you can do anything as long as you don't embarrass the Marine Corps. But this is clearly embarrassing the Marine Corps and the U.S. government now.
Yeah, that's outrageous. Okay, so as this is happening, and people are justly outraged at the fact that this guy cannot be prosecuted because of the U.S. Saying that he's immune with that, how is this being used by the left, and how is this playing into the whole aspect of Japanese and U.S. military cooperation there? Because we've got Donald Trump talking about how Japan and South Korea and even our European allies need to shoulder more of their own defense costs.
And Japan is willing to do that, but Prime Minister Abe spent almost all of the meeting with President Obama railing over this Marine Corps conduct. That's how far this has risen here. And the reason that happened is because Abe is under extreme pressure from the left in Japan to get rid of the Marine Corps base. So he's got to show real concern. Now, if Obama wanted to defuse this, he'd basically say, all right, you've got Mr. Shinzato to tell you how this guy, you know, his name is Gibson, but he changed his name. He took the Japanese last name to fit better into society. I guess it was to facilitate his being a predator. This guy needs to be turned over to the Japanese for prosecution, in my opinion.
Absolutely. Now, if the left wants to get rid of U.S. military bases, what do they want to do to replace it? Do they believe that they don't need to have any defense, or do they want to start a military program of their own?
Well, the left in Japan is very pacifist. They do not want to have any military. They want both ways. But Prime Minister Abe, as a globalist, part of the Trilateral Commission, is going to push for his own indigenous military forces. He actually is not in favor of removing U.S. military forces. They just want the bases moved away from the population centers. But typically that doesn't work either, because the Marine Corps, you know, brothels move to where the military is. And so it will continue to get. But I want to make this major strategic warning, though, that China is a real threat. And China is preparing to go to war with the United States. And I believe in the beginning days of World War III, China will gobble up Japan, the Philippines, Taiwan, and all the way down through Australia, where they have bought up all the mineral rights. And that's one of the reasons why I don't recommend Australia as a retreat location for people in America or New Zealand, because it's very highly probable that Japan will occupy all of those countries in the beginning months of the war.
And of course, there's a lot of saber rattling going on in the South China Sea, where the Chinese government is building artificial islands and then using that to assert their territorial claims in that area. Now, I'm curious to see what you think about what Donald Trump said about Japan and South Korea shouldering more of their defense burden, because I think he made a good point. He said, we're going to get to the point where the U.S. economy can't shoulder this burden for other people, and then they're going to be on their own with that as well. How do you feel about that?
Absolutely agree with that. There's no way that we can shoulder the burden right now. We have no Yes. business integrating around the world, and that's part right. of the neocon globalist agenda, is to interfere around the world in order to create conflict and animosity against the United States, which will accrue to China and Russia's favor when they want to justify taking out the U.S. But remember, the reason that that China is in these various areas that's on your screen right now is because many of those other larger islands have already been occupied by the Philippines and Taiwan and Vietnam and others. And so that's why they're having to build military bases out of reefs. And they are militarizing them. They've got some fighter aircraft and anti-aircraft batteries on those islands right now. Going to be a lot of saber rattling between China and the United States, but the China will do nothing other than offer verbal opposition. They continue incredulously to invite China to be part of U.S. military exercises so they can spy on us in those regions. Obama apologized to Japan for the marine conduct, but those things mean nothing to the Japanese or anyone else as long as the U.S. doesn't hand over this perpetrator to the Japanese for prosecution. It means nothing. An apology is easy to do.
Well, yeah, we've seen domestically how one particular murder incident, as we've seen, they would use that to create the Black Lives Matter movement and that sort of thing. But you have a situation where, and I think part of what was so egregious about that was leaving that guy to bleed out in the street to outrage the local residents. And so there's those flashpoints that happen. And then the way that it is handled can take something that is justifiable police shooting and turn it into a massive social movement. Now you've got, in Japan, you've got a guy, as you point out, who is an actual predator, and the U.S. standing by and saying, we're going to protect this guy because he has some tenuous connection to the U.S. government, to the U.S. military. We're not going to allow you to do anything to him. That is the most amazing thing. And we continue to see that kind of arrogance, whether it is spying on us here in America or whether it is defending that kind of crime in Japan. Stay with us. We're going to take a quick break, and we're going to be right back with Joel Skousen. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and we're talking to Joel Skousen, joelskousen.com, worldaffairsbrief.com. I want to get Joel's comments on where he sees this election going in just a moment. Before I do, just want to remind you that we have a sale on Survival Shield X2 Nascent Iodine. We're talking about all the unrest in the world, about people who are preparing, as we see perhaps Zuckerberg building a compound for himself. We know that even people like George Clooney have set up their panic rooms. Have you prepared? This is a good time to take advantage as we put these items on sale right now. We got 20% off Nascent Iodine. That's something to stock up on. Make sure you have this vital supplement in your supply. This is 99.99% pure iodine salt crystals from deep within the earth, lab-tested for purity. 20% off at InfoWarsLife.com. Also, for limited time only, we have a special. If you sign up for our free newsletter at InfoWars.com/newsletter, we'll send you a promo code to get 50% off our two most popular T-shirts, Hillary for Prison T-shirt and our Come and Take It T-shirt. And, of course, the InfoWars Underground Insider Newsletter will give you exclusive content that you won't see at our website even, as well as other promo codes on other products. So again, get 50% off Hillary for Prison t-shirt or Come and Take It t-shirts when you sign up for our InfoWars newsletter at infowars.com/newsletter. Joel, the Hillary for Prison t-shirt is a very popular t-shirt because you know what? It really is going to be, the stakes are very high for both her and for Donald Trump. I mean, it's going to be either the White House or the big house for Hillary. And I tell you what, if Donald Trump fights the king here and loses, they're going to come after him too, aren't they? It's going to be quite a contest, don't you think?
It is. Before we go into the election, let me just briefly comment on these high-profile bunkers. You know, people have seen the Borg Cube, the L.A. Basin home with the great big concrete movable shutters that looks like a huge fortress. I think it's very important for people to realize not only these abysmally expensive, that you never want to make a home look like a fortress. You don't want to make yourself a target. You know,
exactly.
You want to make sure it looks in the secure home, which you sell my big book on high security design, et cetera. I really talk about how to do these things so they look completely conventional. You can't tell high security design a home that we design from any conventional home. It just appears exactly the same.
Very, very important point. You know, I covered realtor.com now. It's becoming a trend that these wealthy people are going out and creating their panic rooms or survival homes. They're spending tremendous amount of money and they're selling it. Realtors are selling it now as if it's a feature, but you're pointing out you don't want to make this visible. You want to keep it stealthy. You want to do it as much as you can yourself, and you can do it on the cheap, and you can do it better than these millionaires or billionaires are doing it for themselves, can't you?
And you never want to buy something that's been advertised in the real estate market. This home has a panic room. That means everybody who goes through the home gets to see that.
That's right.
Destroys the value of that.
That's so, right. Absolutely. Yeah, good point. Yeah, let's talk about the election, your final comments in just the couple minutes that we've got. Where do you think this is headed? Give us your sports handicap as well. What you think is going to happen?
Well, I think that realistically, there's about 30% hardcore Democrats in the United States that are going to vote for Hillary no matter what, no matter how warts and all. She's got a very nasty personality. She's very, very hard to like, frankly, even among the Democratic faithful. Mm-hmm. And there's about a 30% hardcore conservative view that's going to go for Donald Trump. And the big point is what's going to happen to this 40% in the middle. Now, as a long-term political scientist, I have viewed this and said, you know, if the media really goes out and embarrasses the heck out of Donald Trump, the middle ground is that people are going to be too embarrassed. The big question is, too embarrassed to do what? To vote for Hillary? I mean, this is very, very difficult to do. And this is why the establishment is totally up in the air over this 40% in the middle.
And I think it's showing up, that embarrassment is showing up in the opinion polls, but I don't think it's going to show up in the voting polls, especially when we see these kind of riots that we're seeing at the Trump rallies. Thank you so much for joining us. Joel Skousen, worldaffairsbrief.com. Thank you for joining us. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and we're going to be joined by Dr. Francis Boyle, a bioweapons expert, in the next segment to talk about the Zika virus. At the bottom of the hour, we're going to be talking to Ja'Kari Jackson and crew who were at the massive Dreamer riots, let's call them that, in New Mexico last night, Albuquerque, New Mexico. They're in Anaheim, California. There's going to be a Trump rally there tonight. They will be there covering that. So we're going to talk to Ja'Kari about what happened. He got hit with a rock last night at the riots in New Mexico. And Alex Jones is going to be joining us with a special report. You know, it's an evil thing, the leftists say, if you read to your children. And he's going to tell you why that is so evil to read to your children. But this segment, I want to talk about what's going on in a couple of articles that have hit. We have this article on the Drudge Report. Smaller cities across the U.S. are opening high-tech crime centers. Now, this is nothing new. This is something we've been talking about for quite some time here at InfoWars.com, the fusion centers that are being set up everywhere. And they're talking about here how it's moving now to small town America. First, it started in New York. They opened up a real-time crime center. They're looking at, they've got all their surveillance cameras that they're pulling in. They've got gunshot detectors. And so they tell you, isn't this wonderful? There was a gunshot. We looked at this guy. We tried to ID him and so forth and so on. But look, they're going in and taking a look at you as well. We've had other articles talking about how they can tap into essentially any video camera that is not password protected, and even the ones who are. They say it's so great to have all these assets under one roof. Yeah, it's called a fusion center. And remember what they did at the fusion center. We had the Mayak report that InfoWars broke in 2009 saying, be on the lookout, law enforcement officers, for anybody with a Ron Paul bumper sticker. These people are sovereign citizens. They're dangerous. They may want to kill you, so be ready to kill them when you see them. And that's what is so concerning as we move forward. And we look at things that happened like this jet situation in L.A. They said these were non-credible threats that were phoned into them, and yet they send out a full SWAT team with guns drawn with these people. And they say, well, we got the assets. Why not use them? Well, we know what's happened over and over again with SWAT teams who go into the wrong home and a startled individual there stands up and they shoot and kill the person. And that's what they were telling me. It scared the people on the plane to death. And they ought to be afraid. You know, when people come in with guns drawn, things can happen. And just because these people are police officers doesn't mean that they won't shoot you accidentally or out of fear. We see this happening all the time. Now, as we move from that kind of surveillance that we're seeing at the fusion centers, understand it's not just going to be the public cameras. It's not just going to be the cameras in your home. One of their key points at which they're going to collect data on you is going to be your car. We see this article today in Wired magazine. Calling an Uber is cooler than owning a car. And all these automakers want in. Well, so does the government. The government wants to come in and take a look at what you're doing in your car. Automotive News just talked about how the feds were flashing their badges to get auto data. They say back in February 12th, and this is before the big dispute between Apple and the FBI on the iPhone of these shooters in California. Before that happened, they said a collection of the audio industry's leading cybersecurity experts gathered at a sprawling FBI complex in Quantico, Virginia. They met with an elite digital SWAT team called the Operational Technology Division. Leaders of this FBI division explained that they were interested in capturing connected car data for investigations, and they outlined the requisite legal process. Okay. Now, after all of this happened, they said, well, this is very cordial. It seemed to be very routine. There was a lot of people there. But then it got crystallized when they saw what happened in the dispute between Apple over the iPhone and with the FBI. And so you got some of these people who were there and speaking off the record and said, you know what? We're trying to make these systems more secure because we don't want hackers to break in and do malevolent things. But he goes, I don't feel very comfortable with where we're at. He says there's a lot of pressure on the auto industry to do a better job with security, but at the same time, we're being told by the government, you guys are getting better at security, and that's messing us up. And you got to understand, at the end of this year, the Department of Transportation, Federal Department of Transportation, is going to be mandating talking cars. They're going to talk to each other, but they're also going to talk to their infrastructure. This is the way they know where you sleep, where you work, everything you do. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight. In this segment, we're going to be talking to Dr. Francis Boyle. He is a leading American expert in international law, also an expert in bioweapons and bioterror. At the bottom of the hour, we're going to be talking to our reporters who are now in Anaheim. They were in Albuquerque, New Mexico last night. They had a lot of video. You can see that video at InfoWars.com. It's linked on the Drudge Report. The title is Communist Anti-Trump Rioters Attack Police, Destroy Property in Albuquerque. There's a lot of different videos that they put up. And we're going to be talking to Jakari Jackson, who was hit with a rock by these violent protesters last night. And they're now in Anaheim, California. They're going to be covering the rally tonight. We're going to see what happens with that. They'll be joining us at the bottom of the hour. But right now we're going to go to Dr. Boyle. He is an expert in international law, as well as bioterror. He drafted the Biological Weapons Anti-Terrorism Act of 1989. He was the American implementing legislation for the 1972 Biological Weapons Convention. He served on the board of directors of Amnesty International from 88 to 92 and on and on. He's very impressive, very long resume. We talked to him back January 29th about the Zika virus. I wanted to get an update from Dr. Boyle. What has he learned about the Zika virus in the interim? I mean, is this something that is being used simply to scare people, or is this a test, or is it what are they doing with us? And of course, when he was back in January 29th, when he talked to Alex Jones, he was talking a lot about the genetically modified mosquitoes that are being used as a disease transmission vector. And one of the articles that Dr. Boyle sent us today was Department of Defense is adding funding to enhance Zika surveillance by military labs. Thank you for joining us, Dr. Boyle. Do you think this is a pandemic test run, or is this something they really want to unleash against us? What should we be concerned about with this?
Well, thank you very much for having me on, David, and my best to your viewing audience. Back up, when I first read of Zika in Brazil, I just had a working hypothesis that, well, maybe this was due to African Zika mosquitoes somehow migrating to Brazil because of global warming or something like that. I didn't really know.
Mm-hmm.
But I then proceeded to investigate it, and I've continued to investigate it. We are not dealing with African Zika. As a matter of fact, the people over in Zika in Uganda, the town of Zika, the town where it was found, they're living quite well without any of these symptoms at all.
No tiny heads, no shrunken heads.
No. And they've been over there for all these years, you know, living with Zika. So that hypothesis went out. And as I proceeded to investigate, my conclusion was that this was a genetically engineered biowarfare agent that was inserted into these mosquitoes. And since that time, I have read here, and I believe I sent to Nico on your staff, my analysis of biological testing involving human subjects by the Department of Defense, 1977.
Yes.
Congressional hearings published mm-hmm. here. And it is very clear here that the CDC lab at Fort Collins, Colorado, has a long history of doing offensive biological warfare work to mate biological agents with insects, including mosquitoes. And in addition, we can also tie this into the University of Wisconsin in Madison, sort of northwest of me here, where they have a long history of doing offensive biological warfare work. And I believe I've discussed that with Alex before.
Yeah.
And then also the University of Texas down there at Galveston, again, a long history of doing offensive biological warfare work. So as far as I can figure out, and again, please understand, I do not have any type of security clearance or access to classified information on purpose. I've never wanted to work for the United States government, but wanted to maintain my independence. But as far as I can figure out, we're dealing here with a genetically engineered biowarfare agent. This GE Zika has a gene in there that disrupts the brain cells of babies. It's a brain disruptor.
And well, as you pointed out when you were here back in the end of January, you told Alex that the budget that the American, that the Pentagon has for biological warfare is three times what they had for the Manhattan Project. And of course, one of the things that's very concerning about this is they bring these things in, the CDC calls them select agents. And people need to understand some of this terminology. They talk about giving them gain of function. That means that the disease itself is going to have a gain of function. It's going to be more virulent than the original disease. They're going to modify it for that. Then they're also going to gain of function also includes making it more easily transmissible. But in the case of Zika, it's interesting because there's been a lot of talk about genetically engineering these mosquitoes. So you've got not only the disease itself that's been engineered for gain of function, but you've also got these genetically modified organisms, these mosquitoes, which are the disease vector. They are the means of transmission for this initially. Of course, it can be transmitted now sexually, but you know that is a part of it as well. So they've got two different aspects here. It's very, very troubling to see our government so heavily involved in something that is so incredibly dangerous and destructive, I think.
Select agents is just a euphemism for research and development of offensive biological weapons using these agents that they've investigated from the very beginning of the U.S. biowarfare program. Yes. We've spent now, according to my calculations, well over $100 billion since 9/11/2001 to construct an offensive biowarfare industry here in the United States along the lines of what we used to have before the Biological Weapons Convention when it was perfectly lawful.
Yeah, and to give people an idea of this, too, there was recently a series last year. USA Today ran this, the Tulane National Primate Center. And, of course, Tulane has been involved in things like the Tuskegee experiment, things like what was happening with Ebola in Africa last year, but or a couple of years ago. But they brought in a disease or a bacteria, an organism that was found in only two countries, Burkholderia pseudomallei, and they had it in their primate lab. They had it in a level 3 biosafety lab. And then all of a sudden they found it in the primates who are outside of the lab, just in the pens. And this is something that gets into the soil and becomes endemic in the soil. And the series of events that USA Today did on this was just absolutely not only frightening, but it was comical. If you look at the science behind it, they come out and they send people out there. One of the investigators comes down with this bacteria, and they said, oh, I'm sure it was in the area before. No, it wasn't. They even had people from the CDC center say, no, that only existed in two places in the world. But they're bringing this type of stuff into our country. They're increasing its functionality. They're making it more dangerous. They're making it more easily transmissible. And then somehow they let it escape from their lab. People should be very, very concerned about what our government is doing without our permission, without our knowledge.
Well, again, you're correct, David, about Tulane. Again, a very long history there of the Tulaners doing offensive biological warfare work. Including the Black West African Ebola pandemic. I might have been on Alex to discuss their involvement in that. They were up to their eyeballs in that one as well.
Yes.
But you are correct, and that is why I think and gain of function is simply, again, another euphemism for taking these biological warfare agents, the select agents, and making them even more deadly. And we're doing that. We now have over 13,000 so-called life scientists doing this type of dirty biowarfare work that I think Dr. Mengele would be proud of. And as pointed out by USA Today in their exposés, well over 300 labs here in the United States working on offensive biowarfare activity of this nature to better weaponize biological agents. Indeed, the Pentagon has sent their researchers out all over the world to find unique, specialized biological agents that they can bring back and weaponized. And that's what happened here with Zika. Zika was found in Africa, in Uganda, in about 1947, and was deposited with the American Type Culture Collection. You can read that at ATCC. Well, it was then weaponized. They worked on weaponizing it, and that's what we're seeing now. As for ATCC, we know for a fact that in the Reagan administration, they ordered ATCC and the Center for Disease Control to ship 40 different shipments of weapons-specific biological agents to Saddam Hussein in Iraq in the hope and expectation that he would weaponize these agents.
We got to take a break, Dr. Boyle. We're going to be right back with Dr. Francis Boyle. We're talking about war crimes here, folks. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and we're talking to Dr. Francis Boyle, a leading expert on bioterrorism, someone who has been involved for decades in trying to enact treaties to stop the kinds of experimentation that we see our government doing. Before we go back to Dr. Boyle, I just want to mention real quickly that we have extended the sale for nascent iodine, the Survival Shield X2, at InfoWarsLife.com. This is something that I have as part of my preparedness package for my family. This is a great time for you to stock up while we've got it on special. Again, I don't know how much longer that sale is going to last. 20% off nascent iodine Survival Shield X2 at InfoWarsLife.com. Also, if you sign up for our free newsletter at InfoWars.com/newsletter, you can get a promo code for 50% off the Hillary for Prison t-shirt or the Come and Take It t-shirt, our two most popular t-shirts. It's our InfoWars Underground Insider newsletter will give you unique content that you won't find even at our website, as well as promo codes for other specials along the line. Now, Dr. Boyle, one of the first things I did when I came here, there was a group I was working with back in North Carolina, and the EPA in North Carolina was running tests. They were actually hooking people up to diesel tailpipes, and they were trying to show how harmful fine particulate matter was. We'd had Lisa Jackson, who at the time was head of the EPA, saying that she wasn't talking about people simply getting sick, but she was talking about people dying from fine particulate matter. Nevertheless, they were giving these people 70 times the safe level that the EPA itself had said. We tried to get a stay order on that and eventually failed because the government said, no, that's okay. We're going to experiment on these people anyway. They were searching for people who had respiratory issues or heart issues and then hooking them up to diesel tailpipes. And so when we look at this kind of gain of function, this kind of human experimentation that our own government does with impunity to our own citizens constantly, I'm looking at this Department of Defense is going to put in $1.76 million for the military to track the Zika virus. I mean, is that, we've seen these types of things done in the subways where they track it. I mean, that's one aspect of this, isn't it?
Well, they just released simulated biowarfare agents on the New York subway system and also the Boston subway system.
Yes.
Despite the fact that the last time this was done, it turned out that the simulants were fatal to certain categories of people. Mm. So we have no idea about these simulants, but you know, basically they're testing out the effectiveness of their biowarfare agents on cities, whether they're foreign cities or our own cities. We know for a fact that the anthrax attacks of October 2001, that came from elements of the United States government. That was super weapons grade anthrax, probably produced by Fort Detrick, Dugway, and Battelle. And it was Battelle that recently released these biowarfare simulants on the Boston MTA.
So isn't it interesting that they would have, just as we're coming up to the Summer Olympics, we're going to have people from all over the world going to Brazil. Isn't it interesting that this weaponized Zika, along with the weaponized mosquitoes that they've genetically engineered, show up in Brazil? At the same time, we've got the Department of Defense coming out and providing a couple of million dollars to track its spread throughout the world. Isn't that interesting?
Well, the Zika Olympics should be moved for sure. That's a no-brainer.
Mm-hmm.
This GE Zika is just too dangerous. We know that it basically destroys fetuses in the woman's womb. We also know it gives Guillain-Barré syndrome that paralyzes people. There are all sorts of other side effects that happen to adult males and adult females. We simply do not know yet the total consequences of how dangerous this GE Zika really is. And second of all, it is easily transmittable by a mosquito bite. It goes by blood one of the ways. So, for example, if you go to Brazil for the Olympics and you get bitten by one of these mosquitoes, then you go home and you get bitten by another mosquito, that second mosquito can then convey the GE Zika to someone else. And, you know, it could be a pregnant woman or a woman contemplating getting pregnant.
And of course, it is sexually transmitted as well, we've heard. I'm not sure if you agree with that or not. We don't know for sure. But of course, you say they need to shut down the Olympics. They know they're not going to shut down the Olympics. If it was any other kind of event, yeah, there would be a chance we could shut it down. But people are so sports crazy. This is the perfect venue for them to release this. Thank you so much for joining us, Dr. Francis Boyle. Where can they find more information about you? Okay, we'll be right back.
We're on the march.
Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host. We're joining our reporters now in Anaheim, California. Jagari Jackson and crew are in California for the Trump rally tonight. Of course, they were in Albuquerque, New Mexico last night. You can see the videos that they shot. Amazing video at Infowars.com. It's linked at the Drudge Report on video. And Jagari Jackson, we're going to talk to right now, was actually... Jagari, you got stoned last night, right?
I was stoned by... anti-Trump zealot, I guess you would say. Scott Jackson reporting live from Anaheim, California. But what you're referring to, David, was a situation that happened out in Albuquerque. And what that was is the guy who hit me with the rock. This is after protesters had breached the barricades that the police had set up. This is several hours later. Many people were beating on the glass to the convention center trying to actually break into the door. The cops eventually came with the riot gear, with the horses, started pushing people back. And that's when they eventually had to get to the point where they used tear gas because people were throwing things not just at the police officers, but the horses as well. And it's just a matter of time before the horses decide to trample somebody.
They're yelling behind you right now. It's already heating up there in Anaheim. Is that right?
Oh, yeah. I'll give you a quick panoramic. So this is the scene outside the Anaheim Convention Center. And there's a good crowd out here. It's not as many people as it was last night, but there's still plenty of people out here. Of course, the officers out here, Secret Service as well. But going back to the story with The Rock, this guy, or a bunch of guys, it wasn't just him, but that's the one guy who was on camera at the time, were throwing rocks, not just at the police, but at the demonstrators, because these guys were in the back of the crowd throwing the rocks forward, so they didn't have very good aim. And the guy who hit me picked up a handful of rocks, so I wasn't his intended target. I was only like 10 yards away from him, but in that handful of rocks, he threw, one of them hit me in the face. Right, wow. Up here, like I say, he didn't hit me too hard because he wasn't aiming for me. But you know, I decided to confront him about that, and he just took off running. When he was confronted with the light of the truth, I said, "Hey, man, why you hit me with a rock?" And he takes off running. But as of right now, everybody is pretty peaceful. Of course, you know, you do have your demonstrators out here, pro and against Trump, and that's some of the people that you hear there in the background. But right now, it's a very peaceful scene here in Anaheim.
Now, it was very peaceful last night until after the rally. From what I understand, the reports were that it was very quiet, and then after the rally, things really heated up, and that's when it got violent. And as the police were saying, it was a gauntlet of hate that the Trump crowd that was there at the rally, as they were leaving, that they say is when it got violent.
Yeah, because the footage that you're rolling around, but yeah, that's the guy who hit me with a rock right there on the screen. But what the situation was is, if you watch some of our earlier videos during the daytime when we were talking to the pro-Trump people who were going inside the building, they had the exit blocked so they couldn't come out because all the protesters, when they breached the barricade, they were standing there at that door that the people had entered to go in. So the protesters were beating on the door, trying to kick in the door, and eventually the officers came out, and like I said, the horses riot gear, and slowly started to push the line back. And, you know, this happened over several hours. It wasn't an immediate thing. The protesters breached the barricade, and they slowly were pushed back to the point where they started to attack the officers, throwing bottles, even barricades at them, and the police responded by firing the tear gas.
I'm looking at reports that say that they smashed a glass door that was leading in there. Of course, we see reports that they attacked a guy in a wheelchair. And tell us about that. Did you see that?
Yeah, basically, they had the line set up. To give you somewhat of a visual, like, you see this sidewalk right here behind me. So they had on one side the pro-Trump people, on one side the anti-Trump people. So this guy was in his wheelchair. He was rolling down the sidewalk, and the anti-Trump people decided to assault the guy by throwing a water bottle at him, which was, you know, completely pathetic, and I just don't know how they justified using such a heinous action against a guy who was, you know, clearly disabled, not in the means to fight himself. But that just shows you the mentality of these people, David. There's some big, you know, tough operator-looking guys out there, you know, with the khaki pants that Biggs likes to wear. They didn't mess with those guys. They picked on the guy in a wheelchair. That's who they decided to target.
Yeah, they're bullies, and they're filled with hate. But, of course, they're not going to be They're not going to come after them for a hate crime. You know, when I look at the way the media is reporting this, BBC headlines, for example, violent protests at Trump New Mexico rally, they make it very passive, or they make it unclear as to where this aggression is coming from, deliberately doing that. They don't say there were violent protesters against Trump. They say there were violent protesters. You know, things happened because of Trump is the way that it looks at. But we've got people there who were burning American flags, flying Mexican flags, and yelling insults at people, throwing stuff at people in wheelchairs, yelling things in Spanish at the people who were there.
Yeah, it's completely ridiculous. Just like you said, they didn't want to specify who was doing the violence. As our audience knows, I'm in no way, shape, or form a Donald Trump supporter, but it wasn't the Donald Trump people who were out there doing those horrific things. Everybody I talked to on the pro-Trump side, they were very, you know, polite, well-spoken. They just went inside the event. They said a lot of people weren't even pro-Trump. I met a lot of libertarians out there who said they just wanted to hear what the guy had to say. They didn't want to be filtered through, you know, whatever ex-news agency. They wanted to hear it straight from the guy's mouth what exactly he stood for, and that's what brought them out for that event. But, you know, the pictures speak for themselves, David. You know, we can elaborate on it all day, but you can show that footage of these guys yelling, cussing at men, women, and children, profanities, racial epithets, all type of manner of just shenanigans that went on out there at the event.
You know, Jakari, when we talk about this, and you mentioned libertarians being there, and I watched the libertarian debates they've had where they talk about open borders, and yeah, I understand we want to allow people to move about freely, but there's a difference. This is not the Ellis Island experience that they're trying to sell people. Okay, people didn't come here from Europe, from Italy, from Ireland or Germany or whatever. They didn't come here waving the flags of the countries that they came from and attacking people, trying to shut down their free speech. These are dreamer riots. And at some point, we've got to understand that it's not illegal immigration we're talking about. It's illegal invasion that we're talking about. When people come here, they're hostile to your way of life. They're hostile to your form of government. When they get violent and they make demands and they say, we want to make America Mexico, then, you know, what you're talking about here is an invasion. You can't control the number of people who are coming in. They don't want to be assimilated. You have to control the number of people who are coming in at any given point in order to have an assimilation. Instead, this is truly an invasion, I believe. What do you think, Jakari?
Well, the issue is when they hear people talk about, you know, controlling the border, you know, they always bring up the men, women, and children. You know, they'll show the crying grandma on TV who's coming on the border. And yes, that does happen. But you can also go to these ICE facilities. You can also go to the Border Patrol facilities. And you can see some of these guys who come over the border do not come here with the best of intentions. And it's not a racial deal. It's not just people from Mexico in the Central American countries. You got people coming from foreign countries. You got, you know, guys like Al-Qaeda who would love to walk across that border if it wasn't there. You have a border for security.
Oh, absolutely. We've got Obama rushing to get in his quota that he's set for himself, his goal of getting in 10,000 people from Syria this year before he gets out of office. And so what they're doing is they're going through. They've approved just in the last week, just this last, let's see, it was Monday alone. There were more than were approved in the entire months of January or February, just in one day. So he's really accelerating this. And so you have to ask yourself, are they vetting these people? If they're going to bring in 10,000 people, what if 1% of them are terrorists? They're going to bring in 100 ISIS members as terrorists? Are they going to be able to vet them for disease when they come in? No, that's not the intention. This is
that they're willing to take.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. So that's the point. It's not simply about where these people are coming from, but it is who is coming in. And I think the thing that is really going to turn this election for Donald Trump are the actions of these people. They say, we've been mischaracterized. You're saying that we're violent criminals. You're saying that we don't respect America because we come here illegally. What are we seeing there? We're seeing violence. We're seeing people saying, you know, burning the American flag, flying the Mexican flag. And basically, they're saying everything. They're showing us that they are everything that Donald Trump accused them of being, and far more, quite frankly. He wasn't rough enough on them, I don't think.
Well, the thing, I saw a conversation between two Latino men, if that's the politically correct word, and one of the guys was being very nasty and, you know, racial things, profane things. And the other guy said, hey, when you act like this, you make people believe that we're the way that, you know, we're projected to be in the media. He said, yeah. If you can come out here and have a calm civil conversation with somebody and respect them and respect their points of view and actually try to understand why they think the way they do so you can better try to turn them to your cause, that would help you a great deal as opposed to yelling at people and throwing barricades and, you know, lighting fireballs and throwing them at the cops. I don't think that helped their cause at all.
No, it's not at all. Now, you're going to be there. You're in Anaheim. There's going to be a rally tonight, and we'll be looking for videos coming from there. What time is that rally going to start tonight, Jakari?
Well, right now, it's plenty of stuff going on. I'll give you another panoramic. We'll be out here for as long as it takes, David, but there's a lot of people out here right now, people protesting, people pro-Trump, people anti-Trump. So we'll be out here to bring you the latest.
All right, it's already started. Thanks a lot, Jakari Jackson and the InfoWars crew in Anaheim, California. Now, there was an article that came out, and Alex Jones has a report about this, a professor saying it's evil if you read to your children. Let's go to that report.
Again, I just want to commend Michael Zimmerman, Jakari Jackson, and our reporters that have the courage. A lot of mainstream media reporters don't have the courage to go down on these anti-Trump, anti-American, authoritarian riots. But our folks do go into the midst of this. And I just want to say all of our crew, from Rob Dew to Darren McGreen to Kit Daniels to Don Salazar to just everybody, all of our reporters, Joe Biggs, you name it, Leanne McAdoo, I can't list them all here, Paul Watson, it just goes on and on. Whether it's going into Mozambique in Europe or going into Paris and the no-go zones, or whether it is Bilderberg and our people getting arrested, it's amazing what true journalists and true activists for freedom are doing. We wear our bias on our sleeve that we love liberty, we love freedom. And that's why it's more important than ever that you support the InfoWar, that you go to InfoWarsStore.com and see the amazing products, because just as our news and information and analysis is spot on, cutting edge, and on fire, so are the water filtration systems, the non-GMO heirloom seeds, the nutraceuticals, the Patriot apparel, the Hillary for President, the Molon Labe, the Come and Take It. Everything we do is about being hardcore, in your face, shooting you straight, plain talk, Americana, bare knuckles, in the street. And I'm telling you, this will trump globalist sniveling, manipulation, and garbage anytime. So InfoWarsStore.com, I want to thank you all for your support so our reporters can be out there risking their lives, quite frankly. And at the same time, I want to encourage everybody to go sign up for the free newsletter, because we can get key intel, key reports, key information to you as censorship intensifies across the web, InfoWars.com/newsletter. But because I mentioned this yesterday, I want to go over this report just for a minute or two here right now, and then throw it back to David Knight. This is out of the National Review. There's several other articles where you can actually go to this professor's writings. They are incredible. We should do a whole report on him. Professor, if you read to your kids, you're unfairly disadvantaging others. So again, if you exercise, it's not right you've got bigger muscles. Or if you jog, it's not right that somebody that weighs 500 pounds can't do that. You see, having a mother or father is bad, being a he or she, because some folks aren't a he or she, they say. So your identity hurts them. You understand? This is how they're conquering culture. And you think, well, that'll never happen. Everything else happened. They got our kids. They have our kids in the schools. But it's worse than I was even saying. I keep forgetting to go to the last page. And National Review should have had the headline, Professor Calls for Abolishing the Family. But I've read in the textbooks that the main colleges, like UTU's, I've shown it on air, the family belongs to a bygone barbaric era and must be eradicated. Well, here it is again, National Review, a quote from him on ABC News in this country. At one point, Swift even flirted with the idea of, quote, simply abolishing the family as a way of solving the social justice problem, because there would be a more level playing field if we did, but ultimately concluded that it's in the child's interest to be parented, and that parenting a child makes for what we call a distinctive and special contribution to the flourishing and well-being of adults. So the state may allow parents for now, because we admit there's something there kind of cutesy. In their textbooks, they say they're getting rid of it. They are getting rid of it. They're saying your kids belong to the state on MSNBC. But they're just getting you used to it right now. These people are dangerous.
So part of it is we have to break through our kind of private idea that kids belong to their parents or kids belong to their families and recognize that kids belong to whole communities. Once it's everybody's responsibility and not just the households, then we start making better investments.
The Violence Policy Center once in an article where they were bad-mouthing me said, I don't care what Jones does. We got your kids in the schools. We will take your guns. Remember the Attorney General said, we're going to brainwash you to get the guns. Remember that IRS employee called in and said, we're going to arrest you people. It doesn't matter. We're coming for you. On MSNBC, they say, of course, arrest the Tea Party. They're evil. Of course, we persecute you with the IRS. They're very proud of their evil. The Nazis thought they were good running around doing bad stuff. They thought they were the good guys. It's like that skit I saw. I forget which show. Like, we're wearing skulls and we're wearing black. We kill everybody. Maybe we're the bad guys. We started the wars. Maybe we're the bad guys. Yeah, exactly. You're the bad guys, okay? Doesn't mean mainline conservatives aren't bad either, but libertarians, patriots, we're the good guys, okay? We're the ones that want prosperity and freedom and private property and the right to self-defense. And you can live like you want, do whatever you want, decriminalize drugs, whatever. Just get off my back and don't try to teach my five-year-old how to put a condom on. But look at this. According to a professor at the University of Warwick in England, parents who read to their kids should be thinking about how they're unfairly, this is a quote, unfairly disadvantaging other people's children by doing so. This is on ABC News. They interviewed Professor Adam Swift, said that since bedtime story activities do indeed foster and produce desired familiar relationships, he wouldn't want to ban them. Oh, not yet. So they introduced that idea. But that parents would engage in bedtime story activities should definitely at least feel kind of bad about it sometimes. Like, if you're beautiful, feel bad about it. And then they go on to say they don't realize how bad this is or how bad it is to give them, can't be justified. Private schooling cannot be justified by appeal to these familiar relationship goods. So see, getting better school than somebody else, no one can have anything. Only the elite can divvy up and distribute and create this mentally ill culture where they decide the winners and losers and totally control civilization. And where a computer decides which job you get. But of course, who programs that computer? This is the whole zeitgeist, giant prison gulag program. This is total, absolute authoritarianism. So great job to the crew, great job to the viewers and listeners, great job to our affiliates. It is so amazing. It's surreal to come out and call Lynn Beck a pot-bellied goblin laying supine on his stomach before Zuckerberg, and to see that in newspapers all over the country and people walking to me on the street. I mean, it is getting crazy in the InfoWar where almost every day things we talk about become memes and change the news. That's not a power trip for Alex Jones. That's a great responsibility. And that all goes to you, the viewers and listeners, the affiliates, the sponsors, Matt Drudge at DrudgeReport.com, who's helped boost us over the years. But we're all in this together, and it's wonderful to know we're the patriots, and it's great to know who the enemy is and to be taking action against them. Back to David Knight.
Thanks, Alex. And, of course, we're going to be back right after the break. We're going to talk in detail about this report of the Washington Post, a Univision reporter who went to a commencement address. You know, it's interesting how these commencement addresses work out. We had Tom Brokaw talk about how we needed to confiscate guns and how guns in the hands of the people was essentially domestic terror. Now we've got a Univision presenter who goes to a commencement address for a journalism school and starts going off on a Spanish rant. Yeah, also anti-Trump. And we'll show you what happened at that event when we come back. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight. This is our last segment of the first 3 hours, but Rob Dew is going to be with us in the fourth hour. He's got a big fourth hour coming up. Also, before we go to this report about what happened to the Spanish speaker at the journalist, the journalism school commencement exercise, I want to let you know that we've extended this sale. I don't know how much longer it's going to go for Survival Shield X2, 20% off of our nascent iodine, Survival Shield X2. You can find that at InfoWarsLife.com. Also, if you sign up for our InfoWars newsletter, that's the InfoWars Underground Insider. If you sign up for that at InfoWars.com, we'll send you a promo code for 50% off our two most popular T-shirts, Hillary for Prison and Come and Take It. Those are great T-shirts, and it's a great newsletter. It's got a lot of original content that you're not going to find at our website or elsewhere. Again, 50% off those T-shirts when you sign up for the free newsletter and 20% off of Survival Shield X2 Nascent Iodine at InfoWarsLife.com. Now we'll go to this report from the Washington Post. I think it's very interesting, the reaction of the crowd. You know, I think people have just about had it with having this political correctness shoved down our throats. This is a commencement exercise at California State University, Fullerton. They had a speaker there. She talked about Donald Trump, and she started going off in Spanish at a commencement event. Okay, this is a journalism school where you would expect that people would learn English. Look, if you want to get ahead you need to understand that you need to be able to speak English. When we went to Denmark in Copenhagen to cover the Bilderberg meeting there, signs everywhere were in English. As a matter of fact, if they were in only one language, what we saw throughout Copenhagen was it wasn't in their native language, it would be in English. They would put up signs in English and then often in their own language as well, because that's where you're going to get ahead. You need to understand that. For your own good, you need to learn English. Instead of us importing all the students who want to come here, get an education for free in the United States, and tell us that they want to be educated in their native language, no, they need to learn English even for their own benefit. We can't afford to educate all the children in the world. We can't afford to educate them, certainly, in the language of their choice, but it's to their advantage to learn English. Now, in the past, educated people needed to know Latin, or they needed to know French. The lingua franca today is English, all right? Now, this is Denise Dela Cruz, a graduating senior, also Hispanic. She wrote about this event for the OC Weekly. She said, Salinas' speech was well-received until it became a little too Latino-centric for some and blatantly anti-Trump. The Univision broadcaster began specifically congratulating Latino journalism students for what seemed like a large chunk of her speech. And here's the crowd reaction. Let's play that clip.
Something that a candidate said, well, thanks to technology, now we can prove that the candidate actually said what he or she said they didn't say. So thank God for technology. Well, imagine they blame us so much for so many things that now they're even blaming us, the media, for creating Donald Trump. Imagine that. Isn't that terrible? But we didn't, right? Who did it? I don't know. Who did it? But they're to blame. So I just want to close with telling you that.
Okay, so she started after that clip there. She went into Spanish. That's what I really wanted to hear. I wanted to hear the crowd booing, but we don't have that queued up right there. But basically, she goes off and she starts talking about talking in Spanish, and the crowd booed her off the stage. Dela Cruz said she looked around and she said a lot of graduates were visibly upset. Some were muttering criticism. She said there's probably 100 graduates there, so I can't speak for everyone, but definitely the row where I was seated, there were upset people, and you could hear them heckling her from the crowd. See, here's the issue. They don't want to assimilate. They don't want our form of government. They want Mexico. They can go back to Mexico if they want Mexico. Instead of making America Mexico, they don't want freedom. They want free stuff. They want our stuff. They want our country. They don't want our way of life. Now, there's a lot of Hispanics who do, and they shout down those people, and I expect that they will vote in this coming election. They know that they don't want a Mexico here in America. They don't want that form of government, and I think they'll vote accordingly. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Rob Dew, fourth hour. Welcome back to the fourth hour of the Alex Jones Show. Rob Dew is going to be taking over in the next segment. He's going to be talking to Ella Grace, who's author of America is Infected. She's going to talk to you about the situation that happened with her family, the way Child Protective Services came after her with a situation because her child caught a disease. In this segment, I want to go back to something that I just briefly touched on earlier in the show. There's this article from Wired Magazine saying calling Uber is cooler than owning a car, and all the automakers want in. Now, they're focusing in this article on how all the automakers are making alliances with Lyft or with Uber or with some of these other ride-sharing software companies. So you've got General Motors, as they point out, poured a lot of money into Lyft. They're going to be doing a joint effort there. Toyota and Volkswagen are joining up with others. Israeli ride-hailing startup Gett is going to be joining up with Toyota. And Toyota is also, I'm sorry, that was VW. They're investing $300 million in the Israeli ride-sharing company. Toyota has signed a memo of understanding with Uber. So they're making all these alliances. And they've made an alliance to lobby Congress. We've mentioned this before. We got Ford and Volvo, the automobile companies, joining with Uber and Lyft and with Google in order to shut down any regulation of self-driving cars. That's where this is headed. And what they're trying to sell you on is the idea that you really don't want to own a car. I remember 30, 40 years ago, they were telling everybody, look, yeah, we're sending manufacturing overseas. Okay, fine. We understand that. You know, NAFTA, we had Ross Perot complaining about NAFTA, said it was a giant sucking sound. They said, no. You don't want manufacturing jobs. Those are nasty. Those are smokestack industry jobs. You want a clean, service economy. And as Gerald Celente has pointed out many times, you know, you want to live in a service economy, you're going to be a servant. Those jobs don't pay as well. They also don't give us the infrastructure for independence, for freedom, for liberty, for prosperity. They don't give us the ability to be able to create the devices that make us self-reliant and give us the ability to defend ourselves. And so now we're going from this, them selling us the service economy, to them selling you the renter economy. We've seen these trade deals that have been put out, and they say, well, the stakeholders have been consulted on this. Yeah, we didn't tell you. We didn't tell your elected representatives because you don't really matter. You're not a stakeholder. You don't have a stake in the future. You don't own anything. And as we pointed out earlier this week, you've got, of the cash that is held by non-financial institutions, five companies have a third of it. Another third is owned by the next 45. Okay, so now you got the top 50 companies own two-thirds of the cash. And the remaining third is owned by all the rest of the companies. But think about how concentrated that has become, how concentrated that ownership of cash has become. Just as we've seen, 90% of the media is controlled by five media companies. And of course, that may be smaller now. That's a couple of years old. We see that five companies own 30% of the cash. Now, are you going to own anything in the future? They say that's not cool to own anything. They say people don't want cars. They want rides. You need to understand what's really at stake here, okay? You need to understand that you don't merely want a ride. You want liberty. You want independence. You want control over your transportation, the freedom to go where you want, when you want to go. Car companies used to understand that. When I was a kid, Chevy had the commercial. Many of you might remember this. You can look it up on YouTube. You had Dinah Shore singing, "See the USA in a Chevrolet," okay? They were selling you independence. They were selling you freedom. They're saying, look, you can get in this thing, you can go anywhere in the country you want, whenever you want, in the style that you want to dedicate your money to, okay? But now they're telling you, no, that's not cool. You want the government to control your transportation and track everything you do. And you want a few multinational corporations to own that car. There you go. That's my old vacation car. We used to get the, do you see that there? We used to get the cooler, put it in the back, and it was vacation time. That was the signal, the nostalgia that it was vacation time. Those days are maybe gone.
Welcome to the fourth hour of Overdrive of the Alex Jones Show. I'm your host, Rob Dew. I am the news director here at for the InfoWars Nightly News, and also editor, camera guy. Sometimes I walk around with an iPhone and ask Bernie supporters why they feel that way that they do, and those are always interesting. In fact, we have our two of our reporters out in the field right now, Jakari Jackson and Michael Zimmerman. They're in Anaheim getting ready for another Trump event, which is probably kicking off right about now. I think it kicked off at 12 noon today. I guess in Anaheim's not too far from where myself and Josh Owens were, Costa Mesa, Southern California. It's about an hour difference. And you saw what happened there with the people spinning out and spray painting and beating up people with Trump shirts on. So we can probably expect the same type of behavior from those individuals. And we're going to be playing some of their clips. I can't play a lot of them because we'll show you a video and I'll narrate over top of it. But so if you're watching at Infowars.com/show, you'll actually see the video of how these people act and how they act around other people's children, the innate cursing. You have to go watch these videos for yourself. You can go to the Alex Jones channel on YouTube. It's called the Alex Jones channel. But before we get to those, I want to play, this is from the article, MSNBC panel calls out Trump for pushing the crazy vortex of Alex Jones, Matt Drudge conspiracy theories. And this is Chris Hayes and his cohorts getting mad because, you know, Trump is putting out advertisements about Vince Foster's death, bringing up, you know, Bill Clinton's rape allegations. You know, he didn't even get to the part, you know, here's that Bill Clinton allegedly flew on pedophile Jeffrey Epstein's sex jet with traffic girls 26 times. I haven't even got to that yet. And that's who we might put in the White House? Are you kidding me? To quote Carl the Cuck. Anyway, let's go to that clip right now. Speaking of cucks, let's see what Chris Hayes has to say about people talking about known liars.
He has a habit, Trump, of anything that's raised to him, anything.
Any conspiracy theory.
It doesn't matter.
I like to picture his email inbox as being like all subject line forward, colon, all caps, yes. Benghazi yes. sex scandal yes. or something. You know,
yes.
like any conspiracy theory, no matter how ridiculous it is.
And he likes to get it from the audience too, right? You know,
yes.
so it's a crowdsourced yeah. campaign, mm-hmm. and he's just throwing this stuff back out there. And so far with the Republican primary, it's worked. I mean, I just think that bringing Vince Foster into the context of the general election is ridiculous, and it's going to backfire.
And this is a guy, I'm sorry, and this is a guy who, what did he raise the specter that Ted Cruz's father
yes.
had a hand in the Kennedy assassination? So, I mean, it's
on election day in Indiana, which right. he later was like, oh, well, I don't know, it's just out there.
Right. There are no holds barred for Donald Trump, and I absolutely agree. There's no downside for him in with this electorate. This works, and I expect he's going to continue doing it.
This electorate, though, is the key question.
Right.
I mean, to me,
exactly.
this seems, yeah. and Michael, I think you've been a really astute observer of how this played out in the primary, but to me, there are lots of ways of going after Hillary Clinton that may or may not be effective. Maybe Vince Foster was, maybe the ex-president and his wife, the current presidential nominee, had a dude murdered. First of all, that's not a normal, I just want to be clear, this is not a normal campaign like, oh, they're really getting in the mud and one's calling the other a possible murderer. No, like, this is not never normally happens.
Right.
It also just doesn't seem. It doesn't seem particularly politically expedient to me. Why has we spent the first 8 days, and maybe there's no explanation, right into the 90s stuff? Like, that just seems like such a bizarre place to go.
I can't speak to his mind. I mean, literally, he could have seen one of those 90s era, like the most repugnant 90s era bumper sticker, which was, if Vince Foster had a gun, he'd still be alive.
Remember that one?
You know, that could have been the reason.
Like anything that flitted across.
But the thing is that Trump, it seems that the Republican electorate, at least so far, had such a low bar for him to clear
right.
as far as credibility.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe that is the public's bar, that in a sense, people, the idea that he would say crazy things is sort of just built in.
I don't want to diminish the people that are out there that feel a certain amount of angst and anxiety about the economy. And to me, anything that they're hearing that just pokes jabs at their view of the establishment, I think is what's carrying the day. And any sort of conspiracy theory, anything from the 80s, the 90s, or even beyond, I think is just continuously stoking that fear.
But this also just feels very narrowcast to me. I mean, this really is like, I really think, it's been amazing to watch this. I mean, you got Alex Jones, who I've been watching a lot recently. He's like the main conspiracy theorist, the sort of probably the most popular in American life right now. You know, Roger Stone goes on that show every day.
Right.
There's this crazy vortex of all that stuff back from the 90s and Dan Burton firing a gun, you know, into a pumpkin or whatever the hell it was. All of that stuff, which has been simmering there forever and Judge has stoked, is now sort of exploding through the channel of Trump. And part of the challenge, Michael, it strikes me is, and you just, Basil, referenced it, right? Like, the press covers what candidates say.
Right.
It's almost like, you know, on the floor of the House or the floor of the Senate, you can say whatever you want, right? Like, there's total protection for libel and things like that, for slander. Like, here is Donald Trump. He can say whatever, and it's going to get covered because he's the candidate.
Wow. Yeah. So they're really running scared right now. They are pissed off that these things are being brought back up because they want to anoint Hillary and install her into the presidency. And they don't want you to have a say. And they're really pissed off that a lot of America is responding to Trump's message. Now you have this vocal minority who wants socialism and wants to turn most of the Southwest into Mexico, running around bitching. I'm venturing to guess that a lot of these people aren't even American citizens. This next guy, he is, but we're going to play this video. This is somebody Jakari Jackson interviewed right after they shot tear gas into the rioters last night after they were done, beating up people in wheelchairs and cussing out little children and breaking windows and hitting horses, mounted police horses. Anyway, here's a protester that's blaming all this behavior on Donald Trump, and Jakari actually calls him out on it. So here's that clip.
All right, so we're outside the Trump event. It just wrapped up. Well, it wrapped up a while ago, but probably about 20 minutes ago, they shot the tear gas off. We talked to this gentleman, and he wants to tell us his thoughts on it.
The only reason that they started shooting tear gas at us is because an old man was pushed by a police officer. I asked, let him pass. Let him walk away. He had a cane. No, he hits him in the face for no apparent reason. When Donald Trump showed up, look how heavy and hate he brought here. I stand for people, our armed services, Our men and women in uniform, we're supposed to stand united. But he brings division. He brings hatred. We're supposed to stand united, aren't we? Aren't we all Americans? Our liberty is supposed to be upheld. Our Constitution is supposed to be held in the strongest upset.
My bad. I'm going to challenge you here for 1 second. I'm not a Donald Trump supporter at all, but I'm going to say this to you. Donald Trump didn't set any trash can fires. Donald Trump didn't throw any rocks. All the other stuff you've seen out here, he did not do that.
The reason that, fires started earlier. Yeah. But when that man was attacked by a police officer, that incited violence. Obviously, they brought it when they attacked that innocent man. Now, what the f*** is that supposed to be about? My bad. Excuse my language.
Yes, sir.
But, you know, look it. We're supposed to protect foreign domestic. But they're domestic here. They're bringing domestic terrorism to us. We're all Americans. We have the free to stand where we please. We're not sheep. We're not slaves. Oh, my bad.
I'll say what you got, sir.
And, you know, we're supposed to stand. Look at what they're trying to do. They're trying to force us on our knees. American was founded on revolution. We're founded on immigrants. George Washington, we should take example. Abraham Lincoln, Patton, they fought for this country, didn't they? Didn't they do any good? We must stand. We must stand united.
All right, thank you so much. That's one of the demonstrators that's left after the Trump event. As I was saying earlier, this is where, across the street, you see the officers way back there. That's where people were going in, but they exited out of a different door. And this is what's left of the crowd. It's massively diminished. And we'll bring you the latest.
Oh,
okay. I don't know about that. Tell me about that.
No, actual bullets flying. I don't know where the hell that was at, but...
Do you know who pulled the trigger?
Okay. I believe it was a protester, but I don't know that. Probably the cops or a protester. This is what happens when Donald Trump comes to a Latin nation. But also, we're New Mexico, so let's get this straight. We're not in Mexico. We're New Mexico. We're above Mexico.
All right, thank you, man. All right, more reports.
See, you got a lot of anger and a lot of rage from people, and rightly so. You know, our country is screwed up, but Donald Trump hasn't been in a leadership position. He's been a businessman building his own little, you know, financial empire. He's not the one selling weapons to ISIS. He's not the one that's opened the borders up. He hasn't done any of that. So how can you blame him for this just because he's running for president? And you know, these people are scared and they're afraid. You know, they want to use excuses like, oh, he's not a politician. He has no right to be running for presidency. Like, first of all, like, the presidency is this great office. Look at the last few presidents we've had. We've had Obama. We've had George Bush. George W. Bush. We've had Bill Clinton. George H.W. Bush before that. Our track record isn't that good, people. We've put losers into the White House. Total losers. And I say give Donald Trump a chance. He's not a politician. Let's see what he does. He said he's only going to run for 4 years anyway. So in 4 years, you could have your socialist utopia. Now, I want to just play a little bit of let's go to the professional brainwasher. I didn't get a chance to vet this clip all the way to see if I got all the cursing out. So we're just going to roll it and I'm going to narrate over top of it. But this guy is a public school teacher and he's wearing an F Trump shirt. Can you guys roll that clip over top of me while I'm talking so people can see? This guy here, he's a teacher. He's got an F Trump 2016 shirt on. KKK for Trump. And he's out there saying Hillary Clinton is going to be better for his children. This is a lady that lets Americans die. This is a lady that's probably involved in the murders of some of her cabinet. It's lunacy what these people want. They have no idea who the real enemy is. Well, stay tuned. We'll be back with more. It's Rob Due in the fourth hour of InfoWars.com, The Alex Jones Show. Coming up in the next segment, we're going to have author Ella Grace to talk about her book, America is Infected, which has to do with a condition her son developed and how she had to basically diagnose it herself and treated herself because she was not getting any help from doctors, which is typical of the medical model. But before we get to that, next month, early next month, is Bilderberg 2016. Last year, we went to Austria to the giant pyramid hotel up in the Alps. And showed everyone out there how the police were acting like total tyrants, pulling people out of their cars, searching them. We were specifically, the InfoWars crew was persona non grata. They had our photos up in their little booth, just ours with our car and everything, our passport photos. But here's from the Bilderberg website, and the 2016 Bilderberg is going to meet in Dresden, Germany. And Josh Owens and I are going to be there. We're going to go, we're going to meet Paul Watson. But here's what's going on. We're going a few days early. And we're going to, because Germany is, they took over 1 million refugees last year. And they have more coming this year. They're expecting more than that this year. We're going to fly actually into Munich, because Munich is a hotbed for these migrant centers, and also where they're taking over train stations and rioting. You've probably seen the clips on YouTube. I'm going to ask for everybody's help out there. If you know where a migrant center is, or if you know where hotspots are for rioting or anything, please get in touch with me via my email, robd@infowars.com, robd@infowars.com, or contact me through my Twitter, @DewsNews, DewsNews. So we're going to travel from Munich, probably go through Nuremberg. We're interested in anything in Berlin, Dresden, Leipzig, Nuremberg, Munich, any of those areas. If you know, have any information on migrant locations of migrant camps or hotspots where they congregate and cause trouble, because now they're saying most of the crime in Germany is being caused by non-Germans. Because that's what happens when you open your home to people who really don't respect your way of life. They basically spit all over you. So I want to encourage everyone to get in touch with us through those channels, my email or my Twitter. And please let us know of anything, or if you know of people who are trying to fight this right now, this migrant invasion that's going on, that's in Germany. We'd love to interview you, talk about your efforts and what you're up against, especially when it comes to if you criticize migrants or anything on social media, were you visited by the police, anything like that, please get in touch with me. We will be going a few days before Bilderberg. It starts on the 9th, and I think we're heading out earlier than that. So we're going to fly into Munich and check out what's going on there. So please, please, please get in touch with us. You're our eyes and ears out there, essentially. And I'll tweet something out about that today as well. And hopefully we can get some more intel. I've already been talking with several people in Germany, one of which who had a little coup last year, was able to get one of these Bilderberg members at the train station and follow him around and ask him a bunch of questions. That was Mr. Tillman. And then we got more when we were at the airport. So I'm looking forward to this year's Bilderberg. The hotel is right downtown, so I don't know how they're going to block off this giant area that's got businesses all around. I'm anxious to see what the security is going to be like, because I hear German security is worse than Austrian security. Yeah, there's the, if you want to watch it, Bilderberg media mogul confronted at airport. That was Oscar Bronner, who writes for Der Spiegel, I believe. I think that's who he writes for, one of the groups, and I actually confronted him. Of course, none of these guys, even though they're media people, don't want to talk about a giant conglomeration of elites, royalty, masters of finance, business owners who get together, about 200 of them, for a secret weekend of meetings. But nobody wants to talk about what goes on, because it's all private. Yet people are paying for the security. People are paying for the overtime for these police to be around. Yet we're not allowed to know what they talk about, because they are our masters and we are the sheep. And what you get is what's going on in Venezuela right now, where they're having, 900% of the corn flour that they use. That's how much has gone up in the last month and a half. 900%. There you go. So, and they're expecting the total inflation rate for the country to go up 700% by 2016. Be ready for that. In the last segment, I'm going to play a video clip and narrate over top of it, because it does have contain a lot of cussing. Degenerates curse Trump supporters at Albuquerque rally. And this shows the families walking in, the people that are black, white, Hispanic, all walking in and being cursed out by this one man holding a Mexican flag, and a lot of other people too. All these degenerate people that just are afraid. They're afraid of anybody having a different opinion than them. And their opinion is total socialism and total slavery for all. So we'll be back with Ella Grace, author of America Is Infected, coming up next. It's Rob Dew with the InfoWars.com Alex Jones Show. You're watching live. Those of you who may be regular listeners of the Alex Jones Show, well, no, Alex loves heavy metal. But also, he kind of freaked out the end of last week when I didn't show up for work. I missed 4 days of work. I don't think I've ever missed 4 days of work in an entire, 5 year span I've been here. And here I missed 4 days in a row. I was in pain, in bed. My lymph nodes were swollen. I couldn't get up. I couldn't move. I had a very low-grade fever. And I went to the doctor, looked me over, said, I don't know what you have. You could have West Nile. You could have Zika. I don't know. Because they don't know half the time. They don't know. They just go, well, it's a virus. You know what? He's prescribed me some antibiotics and some anti-inflammatories, which that did work. He called it Super Advil. And that did work, but it helped take down the inflammation. But he doesn't know what I have. And that's why we have our next guest here. She's the author of America is Infected. Her name is Ella Grace. That is her pen name because she's, maybe I'll let her get into that a little bit later. But her son developed a condition, and of course, doctors don't know. They can't tell you what it is. They say it's ADHD. And here we have, this is from last year, Mother Jones, February 24th. Sales of ADHD meds are skyrocketing, and here's why. Obamacare and new diagnostic criteria for adults could mean a major windfall for the makers of ADHD drugs. This is what they pushed on here. There's the headline again right there, and I'll scroll to this, which, it's just a $12.9 billion market right now, and it'll be $17.5 billion by 2020. They have an incentive to push this crap on you, which is basically what legalized speed. How you doing today, Ella?
I'm doing great. I'm so excited to be here.
Yeah. So tell us, I guess, start at the beginning. What happened with your son? You were on your way. You're a spa owner. You had living out the American dream with a small business. And then what happened to your son? What's going on in your family?
My son had a strep infection. And about 2 weeks later, he came down with intense psychiatric symptoms. Within 3 days, he was feeling like spiders were crawling on him. He had an acute case of OCD. He was in the corner hiding, fearful, terrified. We didn't know what was going on. We contacted the PCP multiple times. Like you mentioned, we don't know. He's probably playing hide and go seek. Of course, I would know if my own son was playing hide and go seek. So ultimately, we ended up taking him to the ER. Mm-hmm. They did some tests, admitted him, ran an MRI, couldn't really find anything, but did some antibiotics, and he got better. They sent us home with a prescription for Zoloft and told us to take him to therapy. The whole time, I'm thinking, this is crazy. Zoloft for strep. So the next few years, this went on, up and down, trying to listen to the PCP. But exactly like you just said.
And what does PCP stand for?
Primary care physician.
Oh, primary care physician. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Or pediatrician in this case. And, but never fear. You can always have more ADHD medications, but you can't have what you really need, or they don't spend enough time to figure out what's really going on. And so basically things got worse and worse. And it's similar. This condition is called pediatric autoimmune neuropsychiatric disorders associated with strep. But nobody would ever really call it what it was or didn't really know how to treat it. Unbeknownst to me, it's extremely controversial, and I'll get into that in a little bit. Mm-hmm. But basically, we just muddled through. We figured out basically when he got into the seventh grade that even different viruses would cause him to what we call in these kids flare, a spike in psych symptoms or behavioral problems. And the pressure was on from school officials, from everyone around me to boundaries.
Get him on some meds.
Get him on some meds.
Give him some pills.
Give him some pills. Take him to therapy. You're a bad mother. It's got to be something you're doing in the house. And I was like, you know what? I'm just going to quit traveling. I'm going to quit consulting. I'm going to lock this thing down. I'm going to implement total transformation. I'm going to be this perfect mother. And I did. And we worked on that for a year, day in and day out, when he was exposed to strep the second time. And at that point in time, he went off the rails. And that is when I'm going to get into the juvenile courts got involved. The judge tried to take custody from me. It was a complete nightmare. But parallel to what was going on with him, I was also having symptoms, like tingling in my hands and feet. I worked out all the time. I'm a spa owner. I have a certification from the American College of Sports Medicine. I have a biology degree. I know how to eat right. I am healthy. I've always been healthy. And to have these kind of symptoms, of course, I was distracted from them by what was going on with my son, but my hair started to fall out. I had a finger break that wouldn't heal. I mean, they were all like kind of odd symptoms, and none of which was clear enough to the neurologist that I was sent to or the rheumatologist. They didn't know. And I was just like, what is going on? when we fast forward to when we got involved in the juvenile courts, when you go to juvenile court, you will try to tell them what is wrong and what you need, but they will not help you. So don't ever go there. But they will give you a laundry list of additional things that you need to do that you've already done.
In order to keep your children.
In order to keep your children that you already did 4 years ago.
And they assign a minder to you to oversee everything and make sure you're being a good parent.
Because you're completely incompetent and you didn't think to take their cell phone in 2009 before any of this happened. Because you don't know how to parent. So we get into this and there was a new diagnostic test available that came out for the syndrome that he has in July. We got involved in the courts in June. This is a month later. We get back a positive diagnosis. We go to the courts. Listen, there's something wrong with him. Now he's super advanced. We need this IVIG. He needs all new antibodies for this autoimmune disease of the brain that nobody knows what to do with. And so basically, they don't care. They don't want to hear it. They do not want to hear it. They scoffed at me when I tried to explain to them what was going on, what he needed, the best interest of the child. Not at all. They locked him up in cell for days at a time. I'd go get him, bring him back. Any little violation, like if he's out past 7, you can't have any electronics.
And how old is he by this time?
By this time, he was 13.
Okay.
And he had not even been treated for the first strep infection correctly, much less the second one. He's completely out of control. It's like me trying to manage Old Yeller on a piece of yarn.
Yeah.
It's just impossible.
And what was the name of the diagnosis they gave him eventually?
Ultimately, he had PANDAS, pediatric autoimmune neuropsychiatric disorders associated with strep. And I'm going to explain a little bit more about that, but that evolves into something called pediatric autoimmune neuropsychiatric syndrome. Mm-hmm. Which involves exacerbation of symptoms with viruses. And it can also be like any kind of addition of chemicals or toxins in the system through foods, everything we hear about. But everything in the world.
Basically, allergies, your environment's attacking you, and this is how the body's responding.
And his, instead of a flare like with rheumatoid arthritis where your knees hurt, he went crazy. I mean, basically had psychiatric symptoms. Mm-hmm. And nobody could understand it. Nobody got it. He didn't sleep for days on end. But he's a great kid. In between flares, he's awesome at guitar. He's very smart, very handsome. Just a great kid. Just so tragic to watch your child going through this.
But because he wasn't taking ADHD medication, you were being a bad parent, essentially.
Because
that's
not
how you're being treated.
He wasn't taking his Zoloft, or he wasn't this, or he wasn't that.
Oh, incidentally, I put up an article here. Zoloft, no better than dummy pill, says lawsuit. This is from 2013. Pfizer was being sued. So, you know, they're trying to push this stuff on you and mandate it like they are trying to mandate vaccines now. Now, was he vaccinated, fully vaccinated?
He was fully vaccinated, and here is what helped me ultimately, is once we got into the court system, I tried to take him for brain rehabilitation. He went and he got the IVIG. He got 500 milligrams of steroids for the anti-inflammatory, but it was way too much. At one time, he was way too advanced, and he ended up back in the juvenile detention facility. She put him in isolation for 5 weeks.
Jeez.
Solitary confinement. At barely
14. That doesn't mess you up at all.
Oh, not at all. Not at all. So basically, that just really got me motivated to figure out what was going on. In the meantime, I had been diagnosed with something called reflex sympathetic dystrophy, some kind of random, never-ending pain arc. And I was supposed to eventually commit suicide because I was never going to get better. There was no cure. I was doing nerve blocks, Cymbalta, psych meds for anxiety. And I was like, I can't keep up with all this. Yeah. So I'm like, okay, this doesn't make any sense. So I go back to work at the spa and I start to ask questions. I start to ask my clients questions. I start to notice things. I start to look at family systems and dogs and grandparents. And I mean, I was just obsessed with figuring this thing out because it didn't make any sense. And ultimately, it took me, I guess, maybe several months. We started working with a doctor up in New Jersey that was very helpful, ran the lab work. The only thing that came back on my son's labs was a mycoplasma infection. What is mycoplasma? So I started diving deep into mycoplasma. He had some antibody issues, which is typical in autoimmune stuff. Mm-hmm. So I start digging into the mycoplasma, digging into it. And I realized there's not any research on mycoplasma from American researchers since 2004. So I'm thinking, what's going
on? Why is that?
There's some over in India from 2010.
Yeah.
So everything I can get my hands on, I'm just reading it night and day, night and day. In the meantime, I'm trying to keep custody of my child. thankfully, I found this amazing attorney that understood CPS and juvenile courts and helped me with that so that I could keep custody. Mm-hmm. So I start to get a handle on what's going on here. I need to go to the immunologist. I need to take him to infectious disease. Go back to a different pediatrician. Maybe it was that pediatrician. Same thing. I'd like to go to this doctor and this doctor. No, we're going to send you to the endocrinologist and the infectious disease doctor, but we're going to make some little smart aleck comments in the notes so that by the time you get there, they think you're crazy. And, you know, you can get wherever you need to go like that.
Because the state knows best.
Because they know best. Yeah. So ultimately, I ended up figuring out what it was, and it was a horrible, horrible answer, but it is what it is. And when I found the story of Dr. Nicholson and how there had been bioweapons testing done in the Texas prison systems, no less, back in the 80s, that was covered up, I knew right then where we had contracted this organism and how it had spread not through just our family, but also to others outside of our family. I came to understand why everyone I had ever known either came down with breast cancer, autoimmune diseases, went crazy, like this long life of all of these just really, you would think, things that just wouldn't happen to the same person. But ultimately come to find out we were carriers, we were vectors, we were being used to spread this organism. And until we got on the treatment for this genetically modified bacterial infection, we were not going to get better. But we have been doing the treatment now for 18 months, and we are all much better.
Well, and so it's you were having fallout from what chemical weapons testing they were doing on prisoners in Texas prisons?
Biological weapons testing back in the 80s. And there is a patent for this particular organism I'm speaking of filed by the head researcher of the United States Army Pathology Lab back in 1993. Mm-hmm. This organism is called pathogenic mycoplasma. There was a lot of different testing, and I won't get in too heavy, but in the book it goes there. Basically, they genetically modified this organism. They made it heat resistant, more immunosuppressive. They actually wove some of the DNA of specific viruses into the genome of this bacterial infection.
So it could grab other things and
grab
make
other
them
things,
stronger.
It can flare. Oh. It can show this. So it's like a Russian cocktail.
Right.
And so it started to spread in the 80s. It started to, the prisoners came down with ALS, MS, rheumatoid arthritis. Right. It has spread.
Basically any kind of degenerative nervous system
anything,
disease.
Anything, all this crazy stuff from there. It has just spread. It's like a epidemic, and it is everywhere.
So did you work in the prison system, or how do you think you contracted?
Our brother-in-law was in the Texas prison systems, okay, and we let him come stay with us back in 2002, doing the right thing. Mm-hmm. I'm getting back on his feet,
right,
and by looking through all of my son's medical records, I was able to pinpoint it.
That's about when it started?
That is when the symptoms started,
oh
but they start with OCD.
Right.
They start with ADHD.
Yeah.
They start with problems breathing, headaches.
That's the level one, and then it goes up.
And it just goes, yeah, and it is true that stress exacerbates the symptoms. It is true that the chemicals in our food exacerbates the symptoms, but this organism lives inside of our cells. And so basically when we have hormone fluctuations and all of these things in our bloodstream, it causes a chemotaxis effect and causes these organisms to burrow deeper into the tissue where they've colonized. So it is scary, but there is a treatment.
Oh my goodness. And you basically found out all this by doing your own research, not depending on the medical model, the prescribed medical model to find out what was wrong, because they weren't going to tell you anything.
In fact, we had to find it in my dog, and
really?
I fired
your
the pediatrician, and I identified every specialist we might need to go to. I went to at least 7 different doctors for my son, at least 4 different doctors for myself. I just listened to each one of them, and at the end of the day, none of them knew. I took my dog to the vet. I requested a polymerase chain reaction test and from Clongen Labs. And the vet did it. I figured he wouldn't know not to do it.
So here on screen, I have immed.org. In the 1980s, the city of Huntsville, Texas, most of the employment was the local state prisons. In the East Texas town, there was a dramatic increase in neurodegenerative, autoimmune, and fatiguing illnesses that were linked to the employment at the local prisons. Although unproven, it was likely this increases in towns like Huntsville were... So, back in the 80s, they were finding this. Mm-hmm. And this has to do with... I guess, were they injecting this into prisoners, or were they just putting it out in the air?
It's airborne.
It's airborne. So they were just putting it into The air conditioning ducts or the ventilation system.
Yes, and then the wardens and the visitors. And,
sure, everybody gets it.
And then it just started to spread. And by this point in time, the head virologist at, well, name names, but said that probably most Americans are carrying some strain of this by now. Even if it's maybe less virulent or if it's kind of mutated out of its pathogenicity. But at my sickest point, I was down. I looked like I had HIV.
Well, how does somebody go and find out that they have this microplasma? Is it microplasma?
Mycoplasma.
Mycoplasma in their system. How do they find that out? What tests are out there?
There is a polymerase chain reaction test. It's a nasal swab. Mm-hmm. And you can ask your doctor to do it for you. And he probably won't, but you could ask.
He'll probably think you're crazy for asking.
I mean, yes.
Hey, you show him the documents. Look, they were testing this. Everybody's got it. We're in Texas.
Yes.
Please test me.
Test me. And then you overnight it to Clongen Labs and look for the mycoplasma species. And then they'll tell you the treatment is something different than it really is. So make sure you get the real treatment from this website as well.
Wow. Well, and, you know, we don't like to tell people, you know, because I'm not a doctor. All I tell people to do is read the damn vaccine insert, and you won't want to inject these things into your kids. And, you know, of course, I was fully vaccinated. My kids are being spared that fate. But your book, America is Infected, where can people go to find it? And it's got everything that you had to go through, all your trials and tribulations. And
all the doctor's visits, what they said, what I asked, what we found, what tests to run, what treatments we did. Yes. Go to americaisinfected.com and click the add to cart or buy now, whatever the button says at this point in time.
That is amazing.
Get it shipped.
And, you know, this kind of reminds me of the story, Lorenzo's Oil. You know, yes. this kid's dying in bed. They can't figure out what's wrong with him. His dad goes in, but this is before the internet, and he's in these medical libraries, and he develops an oil that reverses his condition. But it took a parent with the will to succeed and the will not to fail. And that's what we need more in this country. We need more people who don't just sit down and submit to the medical model whenever they tell them, take some pills, take some Zoloft, take some ADHD meds, you know. Oh, it's only worth billions of dollars now. Well, it's not a great story. It's a horrible story, but the fact that you're getting this information out there is great. We're going to have you on. We're going to go interview you in the big studio in a second, Ella Grace, and talk more about this. So we'll be right back. You know, this song is based off a real person who was one of the Marines who brought the flag up, I think, in Iwo Jima, that famous photograph. Ira Hayes is one of the men in there, and he, of course, came back home and fell into depression and alcoholism and ended up dying in a ditch. But going back to this page I pulled up, immed.org, in the case of prisoners as experimental subjects, Texas has a long history of using prisoners in clinical trials. According to the minutes of the Texas Department of Corrections Board, selected prisons in East Texas were used for experiments that were conducted using various mycoplasma species to determine their pathogenicity and countermeasures against infection. This likely resulted in the spread of mycoplasma illness from prisoners to guards and other prison employees to their immediate family and members in the community. All right, we just had our guest on, Ella Grace, and during the break, Nico brought in the patent for pathogenic mycoplasma, which they patented it back in 1993. Of course, they were probably using it before that, but there's the patent up there. So there it is in triplicate, people. Anyway, we're going to do an extended interview with Miss Ella Grace here coming up in a second. But before we end our show today, I haven't even plugged yet this whole hour. Nascent iodine, 20% off. The sale has been extended. That's X2 Nascent iodine. If you don't have X2 and Silver Bullet in your medicine cabinet, you are crazy. At least I think so. Also, Super Male Vitality is back in stock. And you know, Brain Force, every time I go out in the field and talk to people, almost everybody that's using our products is using Brain Force, and they say it is the most amazing product they've ever had. They stopped drinking coffee because the Brain Force, you know, gets them up and going, and they don't need, coffee after coffee after coffee to get up. They just take two Brain Force and their brain gets activated. And there's a commercial playing from my own personal story, how I came in at the end of a night. We were premiering the Louis Farrakhan interview, which now has got about 400,000 views, one of them, just the one I worked on, the full interview. And I stayed up here all night just on two brain force. I got in about 8 p.m., took that. I was here till 6 a.m., and then I left, went home, slept for about 3 hours, then came back because I was excited that we were premiering that interview. And, you know, took two more brain force and was up again the rest of the day, feeling fine. Of course, I did sleep a long time that night to catch up on it. But, you know, the proof's in the pudding, so... Plenty of people out there using BrainForce. You should try it if you don't have it. Also, Supermail Vitality is back in stock and 20% off X2. So go to InfoWarsStore.com right now and check out the great items that we have, all the nutraceuticals that are there. There it is, extended sale, 20% off Survival Shield X2. Let's go ahead and roll this last video. The degenerates cursed Trump supporters at Albuquerque rally. And I encourage you to go listen to what these people have to say. We're just going to show you because the language is so vulgar. It's a guy here waving the Mexican flag who is cursing at, there you just saw parents with two kids. There's a girl there screaming at him. I can't believe you have children. You should just hear these people screaming at them because they don't have lives of their own. They think that a socialist utopia is around the corner if they could just kill enough rich people. That's what they want. Or if they could just turn this into Mexico, then everything will be fine. No, that's not fine. The reason Mexico is a dirtbag country and you left it is because it sucks, okay? Because you out there, all you Mexicans that have come to the United States have left your country because it's a total dirtbag rot hole. And I'm sorry, that's the way it is, and that's why you've left, and that's why you've come to the United States. But maybe you should go back to your country and make it better. Maybe you should make Mexico great again. All right, it's been Rob Dew with the Infowars.com Alex Jones Show. Thanks for watching. We'll see you here tomorrow and tonight, the nightly news, 7 p.m. Central with Leanne McAdoo.